Hey, Tennis, this episode is brought to you by the good motherfucking folks at Bevel. Bevel, listen, first month free on your Bevel membership. Head on over to getbevel.com/Pete. Do you know about that, Miss Lissa?
I love when I be feeling on the man face when he got that signature fade with the bevel blade. Ooh-wee. I be like, ow.
And you know it's clinically proven. What is it clinically proven to do?
It's the only system clinically proven to prevent anything that ain't cute. So no bumps, no bruises, no ingrown hairs, nothing that comes with coarse curly hair.
Internet, go to getbevel.com/Pete. Get your first month free on your Bevel membership. Stop fucking around. Now let's get to the show. Cheer.
Come on, everybody, get set, let's go. It's the next episode. It's the Premium Pete Show. News, interviews, all of the info. Listen up, it's the Premium Pete Show. If you want the scoop in the low, down low, listen to the show, cause Milk said so. Fuck what you heard, better act like you know. Miss Lissa knows. It's the Premium Pete Show.
B-boy, where the fuck you at? I've been looking for your ass since the quarter past. Hot peas and butter, baby, come and get your supper before I make you suffer. That's when you had enough of. Can I get hot when you hit the jackpot?
Cheer.
Surely I can if you demand. I get loose and produce large amounts of juice. Can you get used to that or do you need a boost of energy to enter me and get it on? You're getting warm. I can feel you getting closer. Now, baby, down this mimosa. You better believe it's time to give a toast to the woman of a decade. Too bad to be played. Get vexed and I'm down to throw shade all over your body. Whose body? Your body. I can rock a party like nobody, leaving time to take home the loot. Choosy about who I let lock my boot. Let me take sight to your love and the light. Life ain't all that unless you're doing it right. Hey, keep on, keep it. Hey, that's your sister-in-law.
I love. Oh, MC White.
Yeah.
Shit, you spot. Not supposed to let the internet know all about that. Allegedly, that is. But let me tell you something, first of all. Internets, welcome back to another episode of Premium Pete Show with Miss Lissa Knows.
Ow.
Spitting them bars. But you know what? Even more, when you said mimosas, I'm like, yo, every Sunday I've been drinking mimosas lately, and I've really been a chance to, like, unwind.
Like,
I feel like life is sometimes so busy, you know, like a gnat in your ear. Like,
don't talk about gnat like that. It's low-key gnat in your ear.
Oh, not my low-key gnat, but just like a mosquito.
Yes.
And the mimosas in the morning, like, have been making me, like, I feel like, just, like, relaxed. So I feel like, again, I say this a lot all the time, a lot of us spend so much hustling, busy doing what we doing. The work week might be crazy. The wifey, the kids, the this, whatever you do.
Everything.
You never get a chance to really unwind and relax.
Literally, like unwind, uncork a bottle of wine and relax.
Sure, sure. Or just a champagne and pour that orange juice in there.
Yeah. Oh, I have one that I love. I call it a mismosa. It's when you mix your champagne or your Prosecco with pineapple juice.
Really?
It's so good. Oh,
really?
My God. Yes, so good. Or if you're feeling real snazzy, get that orange pineapple blend that they have in Tropicana, and that's so good. Like the pineapple with the sparkling wine. Ooh, it's going to get you going, Pete.
Listen, that strawberry banana, I think apple banana.
That
or whatever.
Might be good, too. You're making Bellinis now. You're mixing it up.
Yeah,
you're making
Primolini. Whatever you do, make your own shit, man. You know, I always appreciate, and I think anything we do, whether it be music, or somebody creating something like, whether it be like a streetwear or whatever it is, in a, on a item on a menu in a restaurant, right? You want it to stick out. Pause.
Hey.
Pause. But you want it where people could see like oh shit, like I seen these you know people making like filet mignon strombolis and shit like that. I was like, oh shit.
What's the stromboli?
Well, stromboli is like an old Italian thing.
Oh, like with the bread?
With the bread, yeah. It had like a pepperoni, a ham, a cheese. But people are mixing it up like egg rolls. Like I see cheesesteak egg rolls.
I see
Reuben egg rolls. You know what I mean? Like a Reuben sandwich. Mm-hmm. I see corned beef egg rolls and pastrami. You know what I mean? Like we live in a day and age where you got to go above the level. Like
you got to eat this.
Well, most definitely.
You
most
are
definitely.
The king of trying new things. Like me, I love trying new foods, but then my problem is when the shit is not good, I am like, I get depressed. I get really sad. I'm just like, oh my God, I should have stuck to what I know. But I mean, I'm all for new things. I'll try a steak and cheese egg roll or whatever, even though there's no egg in the egg
cheese
roll.
Cheese steak.
Yeah, that's what it is. I love chopped cheese more than cheese steak. Like, I am a chopped cheese kind of girl. Shout out to Haji's.
Yeah, but the thing is, most people aren't going to know what, I mean, a lot of people will, but some people won't know what chopped cheese is. Chopped cheese is a hood classic.
It is.
You know, and I think when you're born on chopped cheese, you just have a different type of, hustle to you.
I wasn't born on chopped cheese. Like, there's a couple of food
Your mom
items.
Didn't breastfeed you with chopped cheese?
No, I grew up in Hell's Kitchen, so I had actual milk. So, I didn't find out about chopped cheese until I was 17.
Really?
Yeah, and I didn't find out about oxtails until I was 22.
What the fuck?
I don't know.
How the fuck did Italian know about oxtail before you?
Because you are a black Italian.
Man, you know,
who grew up in the hood. I grew up in Hell's Kitchen, and my mom was, like, running these streets. She had no time for no oxtails.
She was busy doing her thing, Miss Finney. I see Miss Finney out there. Your mother was with DMX, like, a month or two ago.
My mother is a nurse, and DMX was admitted into her hospital. And he went outside. I can't disclose that. I can't get my mother.
I was in there.
Hey, dog, don't be giving up on my business. Don't be telling on myself.
I had over your lips.
So he went downstairs to go smoke a soak. And then next thing you know, he had a whole crowd around him. Listening to him spit. Being extra jerky.
She took like the old school selfie when there isn't even a filter for an old school selfie.
My mom does not know how to take selfies. It makes me sad. When you can see a person's arms, it's not a good selfie. Like, I hate when she takes selfies. Yeah. But I love my mom. Shout out to my mom. She sends me the most encouraging, long-ass messages. She puts me in group text with all these prayer warriors. And thank you, Mom.
Shout out to Miss Finney. But you know what I do want to talk about is shout out to everybody who checked out last week's episode with a.k.a. Podfather, Mr. Chris Morrow.
Brr.
You know, I'll tell you one thing, Miss Lissa. I really thought it was a great episode. And it's funny because I know that, like, at first, I think people who listen to it, and even Chris, you know, it's funny because, like, me and him had spoke before the episode dropped. And I know before he left, he felt like, kind of like maybe this episode.
He felt ambushed.
Well, yeah. And I tried to explain to him it wasn't like that because keep in mind, too, I'm a Brooklyn dude. So I speak straight off of my vibe. And if people, internets know me, internets heard me on this mic for a minute.
Right.
You know, if I was mad or trying to attack, I would have been like, well, Chris, that's not what the fuck it is.
Right.
I was more like, you know, no disrespect or just really just trying to explain myself. And I really did think that a lot of people, I got hit up and Twitter and Instagram let us know. People really fucked with that episode.
Yeah, that was a great one.
And the reason why I say that for is because one, he was able to drop gems, you know, about what he has done. And even when I called him on some shit that I spoke about, and I really learned that my beef ain't really with Chris.
Mm-mm.
But what I really learned, too, is, and I did commend him on that, is that, like, he was the bridge that we needed when we had no more bridge to go to. And he fulfilled that, you know. And I look at that. A lot of people hit me. And Chris, if you listen to this, I want you to know that people hit me and was like, yo, I respect Chris even more now than ever because he spoke about risking his job,
right,
risking his family to sneak us in to tape the Combat Jack Show in the infancy, you know, days. And if you think about that, somebody, you know, put their job on the line. Somebody put their livelihood on the line. So for that, I condemn him. And I did on the show. And I think that, yeah, I had issues. You know what I mean? And yeah, I had certain things that I didn't like that went down. But in anything you do, I mean, look how many Backstreet Boys, right?
Mm-hmm.
In sync. You think about it. You know, keep on naming groups, man.
Backstreet Boys, In Sync, New Kids on the Block, New Edition, High Five,
Shy,
The Temptations,
Casey and JoJo.
Right.
No, but what happens to groups?
They get really famous, and then there's egos, and there's a lot of mix-up with the business, and then there's, like, he say, she say, and then people become superstars in their head, and they no longer deal with each other. They have their people talk to your people, and then things get lost in communication.
Well, here's the thing. You know, unfortunately, that's some of what happened.
Right.
And when you're a group and you're a group of people, things happen. So do I have some issues with what happened? Absolutely. Are they my opinions, and are they valid? Absolutely to me. You know, some people hit me up on Twitter, like I said, and was like, yo, great episode. I really loved it. You know, they really never heard Chris speak about starting a network that they have done so much great shit with, and I'm proud and I'm happy for them. But the thing is, some people, I seen somebody wrote to me like, damn, Premium Pete's salty. And I'm like, nah, I'm not salty.
Where are these comments that you're reading?
People are adding me. I'm like, yo, the thing is this. I'm not salty in things I spoke about on the last episode.
Right.
I'm just bringing up things that happened.
I mean,
some people don't
salty.
Like you to bring up things that happen.
Yeah.
See, in this world, and I told you before, in 2016, you know, people want you just to be somebody, you know, like a carpet.
Right.
They don't want you to be standing up like, yo. But I want to say, and I
want
to touch on...
They don't
on,
want you to be a window and shed light. They want you to be a doormat and stepped on.
And I can't be like that because I'm just going to be myself. And right. I'm excited. And I'm happy.
Do now, you feel like you got closure?
But here's the thing. My beef is not with really Chris.
Yeah, but you still kind of used him a little... Like, I mean, you did have your issues that you did have with him. Mm-hmm. So
and
in
I addressed
those,
him.
Do you feel like closure with him now?
Absolutely.
That you, do you feel like you'll ever be ready to have this conversation with Combat? Because that's who your real issue is with.
Now, you know what? It's not about issue. And at the end of the day, I'm so happy to be sitting here with you. I'm so happy to be doing something where I'm going to reap a lot of the benefits. Not that I'm just going to sit there and let somebody who is not really have me in concern. The thing is, I haven't spoke to internets who want to know. And this is really the last I'm going to talk about it.
Okay.
And I'm going to move on unless we sit down together.
We
going to
beep it next time.
No, but hear me up. I haven't spoke to Combat in a year.
Right.
I haven't seen him eye to eye in a year. So when he tells people, like, yo, we good, we family, that's not what it is. And so many people tell me every time they see him, oh, he's going to call you. He's going to, you know, he owes you a call. Here's the thing. I can't convince another man to do something that is probably right. It's just to probably be like, yo. And the only thing that's right is to do is kind of be like, yo.
Let go and let God.
Appreciate you, everything you contributed. God bless, happy to see you. That's all that has to probably happen.
That is
but
what
I
has
can't
to happen.
Make someone else do that.
I don't even think it needs to happen on air. I just think that you guys need to go sit, have a cocktail.
No,
and just, you
you're
know.
Right, you're right. And you know what? I do want to apologize to the internets who follow me on Twitter and that see me and A. King tweeting.
Yeah.
And here's the thing. It ain't that serious. The thing with A. King, I wasn't trying to be like, go fuck you, motherfucker. I'll come. Here's the thing for internets I want to know. I play around once in a while with A. King. I make jokes.
Right.
Okay, I bother him once in a while on the internet. The reason why I do that for is because I got love for him. And somebody may say, well, what the fuck are you talking about? If you got love for somebody, why are you doing that? Let me tell you something. When everything went down and me and Combat separated our ways, okay? A. King, I understand. He chose Combat. I didn't expect him to choose me. I didn't give him an example. But I spent 5 years with A. King as being a friend. I spent on the phone with him when he worked at his day job every day talking to him. My mother made him her famous fucking baked ziti. He's been to my house a dozen times. That motherfucker, when that shit went down, and it wasn't like some abrupt shit where it was just like, fuck you, Pete, get the fuck out of here. It wasn't even like that. It was just like, I even hit him up. I was like, yo, A. King, it's Pete. I was like, no answer. Yo, A. King, what's up? It's Pete, man. I know me and Combat are going through this shit right now, but, you know, I consider you a friend, man, you know, and you know, call me, man. I like to talk to you. Let's keep it separate. Nothing.
Right.
Months and months. And months and months. And Jonathan Mena, I'll be like, yo, what's up with your man King? And he'll be like, yo, I tell him to call you. I don't know what's the matter with him. Finally, one day, I said to myself, yo, you know what?
Did some baby mama shit.
I tweeted him on the internet. I was like, yo, A-King is corny. Yo, my phone rang 10 seconds later. And he called me. And you know he had the nerve to call me like, yo, what's up? How's everything? What's going on? And I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Because I couldn't do that. So anyway, the point I'm trying to make is after that, I tried to look out for King more and more, give him my opinion. And but yo,
I think you kind of impose your opinion sometimes when he don't even want it, though.
Okay, but here's the thing. I care about him.
Right.
And I don't want him to see the same thing that happened to me. And he's like, yo, the same thing that happened to you isn't what's going to happen to me. But I know there's been hints of that. But here's the thing. At the end of the day, I say this. I say this to say this. My beef is not with A. King.
Right.
My beef isn't even with Combat. I'm able to do my own thing.
You still
I'm able
need
to
closure.
Sit here. No, but hear me out. I'm able to sit here with you and create.
Right.
You understand?
And everybody don't get to sit and create with Beyonce.
No, but what I'm trying to say is I'm in a better
right.
place than I actually thought I wouldn't have been if I would have left.
Right.
So what am I even mad about? But what I'm mad about and upset about is that I thought these were my friends.
Right.
And I may sound corny I sound like an older man saying, what happened to my friends? But I thought.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, one day, that shit just all changed like a light switch. And I say that to say this again. You know, I apologize for tweeting him and saying this, but he started that day writing some things about, you know, fuckery and all this other shit. So I felt like, yo, if you don't support me, don't talk about me. That's what I felt. I felt like, yo, if this motherfucker's out here not supporting me at all, right, then why should I even give a fuck about him?
Right.
Yo, Internet, let me tell you something. If you got an issue with somebody, right, mute them. Mute them on Twitter. If you don't want to unfollow them, mute them, just so you don't have to see the motherfuckers anymore.
Oh, my God. Speaking of muting on Twitter, I wanted to mute, like, 15 people. What happened on Walking Fucking Dead? Like, I don't watch that
first
show.
Of all,
I've never seen the show, but it was trending.
Let me tell you. First of all, Walking Dead's always trending, okay?
Okay.
You're late to the show on Walking Dead. Walking Dead is a cult. It's a cult following.
I'm not
okay?
drinking the
and
Walking
I'm,
Dead
And rest
Kool-Aid.
In peace, Glenn. Rest in peace, my motherfucking man, Abraham. Okay, that ginger motherfucker. But let me tell you something. You know, Walking Dead is beautiful. And it's and I've been waiting for so long for it to come back. And it's crazy because I happened to be in the area by my mom's house and I couldn't make it home in time to watch the premiere. So I called my mother up. I was like, yo, Mom, I'm coming by. And she's like, good, I'll make you the Monty Gorton. I said, yeah, make whatever the fuck you want. I'm going to watch The Walking Dead. She's like, I don't like that thing. Don't worry. So she puts it on, right? We put it on. Let me tell you something. Imagine putting it on for your mother and father who's never seen one episode of Walking Dead. I put that on. She was like, this is crazy. What the fuck? What's going on here to them? He's bashing his head in. I says, Ma, listen, that happens sometimes. But I'll be honest with you, it was like, I'm sorry I doubted Walking Dead. I'm sorry I did because I remember saying like, yo, at the end of that season 6, I was like, yo, that shit was corny. They didn't end it with no, you know, us not knowing who it is. There was no gore.
That's
there was
good.
No nothing, no blood. I was like, that's fucking corny. Then they come back with season 7, and it's a fucking maniac, this guy Negan. Let me tell you something. Negan, somebody needs to clap Negan for the culture. You understand? Somebody needs to clap Negan for the culture. But Walking Dead is official. It's one of my favorites.
I'm not here for it.
Well, check it out, but you're going to start from season 1.
I'm not doing that. I am actually starting from season 1 because it just started. It's a great show. It's on HBO. It's called Insecure. It's created by Issa Rae, and I guess it's derived from something she created called Awkward Black Girl. I love this show. I feel like it was based off of me, and I know a lot of women think it was based off of them, and that's what makes it so great to actually have a show that isn't Love and Hip Hop or a reality TV show, an actual scripted TV show that highlights women in a different light. She's like out here trying to figure out what she wants to do. She has a job that she likes, but I think she wants to be a rapper. That's why I feel like this is based off of me. And then she has a boyfriend who's trying to figure out his career. And then her best friend is going through her own shit. But she kind of is trying to figure out what it is about her friend that white people like her and black people like her, that she doesn't have that quality. Like, it's just a really good show for anyone, not just black women, or females who are trying to just find themselves and figure it out. For me, it's like the brand new Sex in the City. Like,
okay,
I'm
okay.
digging it.
So you want me to start checking that out?
I do, okay. I do. And then there's another show. It's called Atlanta. It's on FX.
It. Yes, yes, yes.
I like that show. I only got into 3 episodes, but I really like that too.
Official. And I've seen Internet's actually turn me on to that. Yo, one thing I love about the Internet, remember I always talk about how it's a gift and curse?
Mm-hmm.
Yo, Twitter especially, man. I'll be tweeting like, yo, Internet, thank you so much for anybody like when I tweet like, yo, what should I be fucking with on Netflix? Next thing you know, boom, people coming in with the suggestions. And I trust their suggestions.
Right. Do you like The Breaks?
Oh, for VH1?
No, what's it? That was that show that's on... It's on Netflix. It's by Nas.
Get on Down. Or,
there you go. The Get Down.
Yeah.
The Get Down.
Yeah, it was official. I fucked with it. Yeah. You know one thing I haven't watched that, forgive me, Internet, but Blacklist.
I don't watch that either.
People have been telling me, like, yo, I need to get on the Blacklist since, like, fucking for a minute, and I haven't got on. So, Internet, I will get on. I'm going to binge on that shit. I'm going to get my snacks out. You ready for this? Internet, let me tell you something. Whoever likes Girl Scout cookies, let me tell you something.
The Thin Mints.
They are making a cereal out of them.
Oh.
I swear to God, it just got info came out. They're making a cereal. Girl Scout cookies will become cereals.
Girl Scouts, are they going to be slanging that too, or can you find that in your local
grocery
store?
I don't know if the girls are going to be slanging the Girl Scout cookies. The Girl Scout cereals.
Because
it's like through General Mills.
Yeah, like who got time to be trying to find some bitch with her fucking patches?
Nah, I'm trying to go to Walmart, pull up, motherfucker, give
right.
me those Thin Mints, put them all in the cart, and head out. I mean, because I'll be honest with you, I don't know how
many. You think that's going to be a good cereal?
First of all, I'm a big fan of Thin Mints.
Right.
Some people don't like mints. Thin Mints in the freezer are legendary. You put them, I'm telling you, I undead stocked my box of Thin Mints in the freezer for Walking Dead, the season 7 premiere. I don't have no more. So I need to find a girl scout who's selling. Right. I need to get some more cookies. But Thin Mints in the freezer, internets, if you've never done it, cop yourself a box of Thin Mints, put it in the freezer, get back to it, get back to
me. Do you drink milk while you eat these Thin Mints?
I mean, you don't have to. I mean, I drink fucking wine when I'm drinking
Thin Mints. That makes sense. I could do a red with a Thin Mint.
Yeah, why not?
Okay.
You know, I don't really like the white, you know.
Yeah, only white wine I really do enjoy is a sparkling. So I can do a Prosecco, I can do like
Prosecco's
champagne.
Cool.
Like,
but white wine is cool with pasta.
Yeah?
Yeah. Nice.
Like shrimp scampi.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Or a shrimp linguine. A shrimp scampi.
It's good with a seafood.
Of a linguine.
Seafood, like, allegedly. I still like a red, though.
Yeah, I like red wine. Yeah, yeah. I definitely fuck
and
with.
I, my new shit is I chill my red wine. Like, I know it's, like, unorthodox and people don't really dig that.
I used to do that.
I like it.
I used to do it. I don't fuck with it
I
no more.
I like
but
it.
But let me ask you something, too. You know what? Last week you called me out on being a secret about Prodigy. And all of a sudden, I see you put up this tweet about your executive producing this podcast. So I'm like, yo, this girl's a fucking a secret fuck. This is a place to let the people know what the fuck you're doing. So what are you doing? Because actually, yo, somebody hit me and was like, what's this all about? Because they thought, like, at first, they thought that she was doing another podcast.
Oh.
Like, what do you think? I own her?
Well, I mean, something that I did clear with Pete in the beginning when I even just started doing this show, because people are always asking me to work on their projects with them. So this is a podcast that I'm working on with a Franchise Global. He works really closely with Dave East. So the podcast is called Brother Stop It. It's going to be like a lifestyle kind of show. I'm not really going to be co-hosting that. I'm going to be behind the scenes. So he's going to be interviewing people. He's going to be, he's like a live wire. He's very much a Sagittarius.
Okay. Maybe we'll meet him one day.
I think that him and Pete should definitely meet, and then we'll see. Maybe we could do like a mashup one day. Maybe you could come through to his show and like sit down. And he's going to be doing sports talk. They're going to be talking about TV shows. He even does like who's the best scammer, like where Burrow has. Like it's a fun show. Like we can't put it in a box yet. We're just trying to iron out the kinks. And that's why I haven't been talking about it, because I want to just make sure that it's going to be done right before I start running around promoting a show.
Well, first of all, and what you're doing is very well, because in 2016, if you can't be a sneak, then you ain't winning. So, you know, I commend you on that. But I do. But the reason why I brought it up for is because whatever you do, you know, the internet should know.
Right. But again, so we taped this episode a while ago. So that's the thing. I didn't want to promote it until we were going to be consistent. Mm-hmm. Because, like, a lot of people think that it's so fun and easy to do a podcast. It's a lot of work.
No, you know.
And you have to be prepared for that. So if you're not prepared, then you find yourself at a loss. So I didn't want to be promoting something that wasn't going to be consistent. And, yeah, so.
Listen, that's dope. And congratulations. And you know, let me know any way I can support it. Internet, you heard what it is. Just check it out. Support it. See if you like it. If you like it, fuck with it. If you don't like it, then
fuck with it.
Then don't fuck with it. Whatever.
We just got on iTunes today.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm trying to tell you. It's a brand new, like, venture.
Well, listen, congratulations. Shouts to everybody involved.
Thank you.
Keep me up to date. Keep the internet up to date.
We will.
Before I go to a break, what I do want to say is this. I want to say one thing that my friend Dallas Penn had told me.
What?
He told me something when after that episode dropped and with Chris Marr, the pod father. he told me something. He says, Pete, let me tell you something. When I drive, I look in my rearview mirror, and he said, you know, just every once in a while, see if who's behind me, see if the cops are behind me, see if something, you know, what's going on. He said, but when you drive, you don't drive looking at your rearview mirror. You drive looking at your front window.
Right.
And I was like, yo, that shit was beautiful.
He's deep.
Because in life, we look forward, but we have a rearview mirror in our car, because car is like life. And we just glance at it, but we move forward.
Right.
And internet, that's not only for me. That's for you. For whatever you're going through, for whatever change you're going through, for whatever situations that you believe in, that you believe ain't right, that you're going through. And that could be anything. See, that's why whenever I go through, I try to help another motherfucker. Whatever you are, man, woman, both, whatever. I'm being real. Like I really mean that. Whatever happens to me, or you know, I try to, you know, let somebody else know. Give them some wisdom, give them some insight. You know? Look, let me tell you something. Anybody who right now who's listening to this who feels that change is tough. You know, for a while I used to I love rituals. I love things the same way.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm getting older, I love breaking that up, that monotony up. Change is good.
Mm-hmm.
But it you know, it's funny, and shout out to my man Anthony Casanova from Florida. He had told me, like, fear is fake. And even though it could be real, but it's really just something you feed your mind with. You fear to change. You fear to, you know, that there could be problems, man. Anyway, you know, there's no need to ever do that to yourself, Internet. Believe in yourself.
And our guest is really good on change because he's changing himself.
Oh, he's the man. Anyway, we'll be right back. Internet, don't go nowhere. You listen to the Premium Pete Show with Miss Listen Knows. Cheer.
Ow.
What's up? What's up? It's Angela Yee. And of course, you're listening to the Premium Pete Show with Miss Listen Knows. And you know what I love about it is that all three of us sit the same with our legs crossed. Okay, we keep it real.
Don't judge us. Now back to the show.
Got that bussy.
Internet, welcome back to the Premium P Show. Miss Liz is here, and I'm excited to sit down with the homie. And I'm, you know, I've been trying to get this done for a minute. So, you know, he said, listen, when I come off for the Bad Boy Reunion tour, he said, I'm there. So, you know, like a man, like a respectable person he is. Internet, welcome Styles P to the Premium P Show.
Yo.
Listen,
what up?
Styles, first off, I want to
salute, bro.
Salute to you, man. And
salute, Queen.
This is Miss Listen.
Hey, Al.
And I really want to salute you because I know your foot got all fucked up.
Yeah, I got man, fucking swole my.
You got the rich man disease.
As healthy as you've been trying to keep yourself.
Yeah.
Sometimes shit still happens.
Yeah, that's life.
Ain't that a motherfucker?
You can't help it.
You know, right off the bat, I want to go into, it's like growing up, like even somebody like you, I relate a lot to you. And what I mean by that is, you know, we fuck around and we do crazy shit and then realize as we get older that, you know, we should change the way we live in.
Sure.
And you've been doing that for a minute. That's why I say
every person should.
Yeah, but some people are out there.
I mean, I think people come into their own time of when they choose to do certain things. I mean, I think as the older you get as a human being, you want to kind of learn from your mistakes, get wiser, especially if you got goals. You know, if you got goals you got set, you want to make sure you can try to achieve them, and the best way to do that is to keep pushing forward.
Yeah. I'll tell you, in 2016, right, I remember we had a conversation a while ago where we were talking about gangster and gangster. And for internets who don't know what that means, I'm talking about G-A-N-G-S-T-E-R.
Yeah.
And then G-A-N-G-S-T-A.
It's now, you always say,
explain to the internet what the difference is.
I think a lot of people, you know, the conception of, or perception of their, what they perceive as a gangster is someone who's, you know, always on a corner or banging or just mm-hmm. a street dude or just mm-hmm. a common thug or, you know, and they just in the, doing street shit all the time. Now, that's a gangster with an A at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a gangster with a T-E-R at the end is a whole different ballgame. That's a person who may have never, ever in his life touched a gun. Mm-hmm. He may have never beat anyone up. He may never have done anything, but he's a man of principle. He's a man of his word. He's a man of, you know, a man of respect, honor, dignity. Mm-hmm. People can understand that. Like, so I think in street life, people often confuse a lot of things. And I think, you know, the older you get, it becomes easier to see it or easier to break it down. Like, you know, the general, he's not on the front line. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
All the time. There's people in the mafia who's probably never touched a person.
Sure.
They dress in a suit every day and they go work at a business.
Yeah.
And they're not on the corner, but, you know, you do the wrong thing, that's your ass.
Sure, and they get looked at like that.
You know what I mean? So I think it's the way you carry yourself. And then it's my perception is, like, people, you know, to me, the biggest gangsters are politicians
mm-hmm.
in all actuality, and those, you know, who own corporations and, you know, the gas people,
sure.
the cigarette people, the pharmaceutical peoples. That's some, you know, the 1% of the world are the most, that's the most gangster shit.
Yeah.
Like, you know, in my eyes.
Yeah.
Personally to me, like, you know what I'm saying? So I think it's a big difference. People often look at gangster and just automatically stereotype it as like a street dude or, you know, a minority or a minority off the corner or someone involved in hip hop instead of looking at all the actions that's involved with, you know, what a person's doing. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, most definitely. I think that, and it's you know, even more so than that, I think people judge, like, even growing up in the hood, you grew up in Yonkers.
Yeah.
Right? Let's take it back for a second. So you grew up in Yonkers, mom and dad?
Yeah.
And what did mom do?
Mom and step-pops.
What did mom do? What did pops
Mom's, like, working, she's like a social worker, group homes, okay. teaching, okay. that kind of feel.
Okay.
My pops was a security guard. My step-pops was a, God bless the dead, both of them, my pops and step-pops. My step-pops mm-hmm. was an electrician on a ship.
Do you have siblings?
Yeah. I have a brother. He's, God bless him, too. He's up there. And I got a sister.
Rest in peace.
Too, yeah.
Yeah. Now, growing up, like, even like, you know, this is almost always a famous question, but when did you even know that you even wanted to even rap? And I say that to say this, here's two things in one. And if not, what the fuck would you have been doing?
Something creative, definitely.
Mm-hmm. I can see that.
Definitely something creative. And something that's going to make money till I find my way. And two, I always knew I wanted to rap probably since I was like 7 or 8. You know what I mean? It was something I knew I wanted to do. It was a life I knew I wanted to be in. It was just from, you know, from the radio.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and from outside, like just from being outside, banging on car hoods, the mm-hmm. local MCs,
sure.
spitting. It probably really the real trigger for me, I would say, it's probably Beat Street. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
when I watched Beat Street, I was just, it was just like, okay, like I really, 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 really know this is what I'm doing. This is where I want to be. I want to be involved with this. Like, you know what I mean?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but you don't write any of your raps down?
No.
So what the fuck do you do? You just spit them off your top of your...
I mean, I'm writing them in my head. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Like, I don't look at that as a big thing like everybody else
does. That's amazing to me.
You know what I mean?
People have reference tracks, so the fact that you are writing and in your head is
It's
double.
Like, I'm just visioning a line. Like, you know what I mean? It's sort of like when you're in... I guess the easiest way to put it, remember when you was in school and you had to study for a test?
Yeah.
And you knew it was like the big test, like you had to know at least like 2 or 3 chapters.
Absolutely.
And you had to read the chapters and then kind of, you know, I kind of had like not a photographic memory, but I had enough to realize, to remember what I need to remember. And if I read it, I could see it how I read it. Like, you know what I mean? If I read it on paper... It's going to come in my mind like that. I'm going to remember, like, not to the T every time,
sure.
but pretty much so. So, well, I'm just saying the rhyme, I'm just pretty, you know, the blend and the beat is kind of my pen and my paper. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Shit.
I'm smoking, and then the line's coming, and then I'm playing with the words, and then the next line's going to come, and then I'm going to figure what I want to say. Plus, if I had a pen and a paper, I'd probably be erasing a lot and always...
Overthinking
or not... Not as much in the moment and
right.
in the feeling as I want to be like.
Hey, imagine if you didn't have any weed doing all those rhymes.
I mean, there's times I didn't have weed, a very few limited times, but I was high already. So
what song did you create without weed?
I guess, yeah, you're right. I've always been high. I mean, you know.
What song did you create?
I don't know. I don't know off the top of my head. But sometimes when you go to the lab, like say if I'm high and I'm in the zone. Like, if I got there, I'm having a good day, and, I blew a joint before I got there. But I don't got no weed on me. But I already got a vibe. I'm going to get to that beat and just go off of that high. And, and I know the weed man's coming anyway, so I already made the call before I got there. So
shit.
I already know what, you know, it's on the way. So it's just kind of being in the, I think with me, it's a feeling thing. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
With me, more than anything, it's like whatever the beat is kind of telling me.
Mm-hmm.
And how I feel at the same time. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just the combination of putting it all together at once.
What's one of your favorite verses of your own?
Because
one of mine is Go Ahead. Like, I think you go off on that.
Oh, thank you.
So.
Uh-oh.
I really don't know. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm a moody person, so it's like one day something could be my favorite on Monday,
right.
then Tuesday is changing, Wednesday is changing.
Right.
And so on. It depends, like, really in the mood I'm in. One of my favorite songs, though, personally for myself, is I'm Black.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like, that's one of my favorite.
Is it because it's so empowering?
That one, because I knew I was throwing a dice at my career. Like, you know what I'm saying? With my career, I was fresh off of Get High. I did like 9 months in jail. I came back out. You know, I had pretty much more success than they expected off I Get High. I think I was guesstimated to sell probably like 50,000 records. I ended up selling like 800,000, 900,000, close to platinum, some shit like that. And then so when I came back out, it was like, you know, I'm going to do what I got to do. But for me being incarcerated, I knew I had to address the issue because I felt like personally over the past few years myself, I think when you're in the industry or you're in the streets or you just getting money, period, in the fast life, it's easy to lose your culture.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, things you grew up on and certain shit. So I felt like, you know, like, damn, like, no matter what, I'm black at the end of the day. And me getting all this money and just being able to move in new places and do new things and be around new people, that don't change that. And a lot of times we forget our history or, you know, where we come from.
Right.
And just certain shit. Because we now have money, or we now
went,
yeah,
we
start,
green.
Yeah, we always think green. So yeah. I think it's important to have culture. So when I came out, that was important for me to do. And it was like, they was looking at me like, what the fuck? Like, you just did I Get High. You had mass success. I'm like, all right, cool. But, you know, this got to be, for me, this got to be said. And I just knew it was all wrong. But ended up working out for the best because I ended up being independent after that. I got off scot-free. Everything was cool. God bless Jimmy Iovine. We sat down
like a
you
boss.
Know, like we sat down like gentlemen. You know what I mean?
Would you say, listen, get me off this fucking contract?
No, actually, we really had a good conversation because I didn't want to have that on my rep
already.
From, you know, the shit to let the locks go.
Sure.
And the things with Puff. So you don't want to keep going in the same direction with the same, you know, with the same kind of shit. So mine was, it was like more like a sit down,
like you know, yeah, like, let's, forget
let's,
about it.
Yeah, let's me and you have a sit down and talk. And I was like, listen, you know, I understand how the machine works and what goes on, but at the time they had 50, Eminem, Mary, so much shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? I like, don't just let me get caught in the machine. And I make music off of feelings. I ain't just here for numbers. Like, you know what I'm saying? So any day of the week, I'm just gonna say what I'm saying for my soul. So I don't think that's a good fit for me right here, right now. And he kind of, and plus I had the joint, you're my favorite drug.
Okay.
And I had that, and I told them to drop on Black from Black History Month, and then come right back with that joint. And they didn't listen to me. And then T.I. came out with it, and it went.
Yeah, went right to the roof.
And then I was like, that's two. Like, you know what I'm saying? That's two things. Like, as a businessman and when I'm heading in life, just let me go, brother.
And he was, and he was totally okay with that?
Yeah, he was. He actually made it real. Man, he made it super swift.
Shouts to Jimmy Iovine.
Yeah, for
real.
Yo,
you know one thing I always hear you say, I've heard you say it over the years, you love hip-hop, you hate the industry.
Yeah, for sure.
But if you could break that down.
I think hip-hop and the industry is two totally different things. I think, you know, for me
yeah, sure,
personally,
no doubt.
I'm going to say hip-hop is something you live, breathe, eat, shit, sleep, wake up, fuck, do everything you could possibly imagine, even with your whoever's involved in your life. Industry is more, my car's better than yours, my chain's bigger than yours, what's the numbers, who's the hottest, get them on my shit, what's the latest fashion. It's maybe no MCing involved. Hip hop, you got to have MCing involved. Industry, it don't got to be no MCing involved whatsoever. It don't even have to be talent involved too much. But I don't really knock that hustle because as a black man, an older black man, I'm glad to see young men get money. Like, you know what I mean? And they don't have to be on the corner or don't be, you know, they ain't got to rob shit or do stupid shit. But it fucks you up when you see. You know, just respect the culture you come from. Like, respect history. Like, I respect past artists and new artists.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying?
No,
I respect anybody in this craft. If you good at the craft, you get my respect. It's not a, you know, because, and it's not an age limit thing. It's just like, you know, and I agree it is a young man's sport. But if you old and you nice enough to be nice still, why the fuck would you hang up? Because it's supposed to go hobby, job, career, stepping stone to another career. You know what I mean? Why the fuck would you want to just say after hobby and job, I'm not going to make a career out of this? Like, that's fucking stupid. And only in hip-hop and rap do they think, well, not hip-hop, but in rap do they think, like, yo, right, you're not supposed to, like the fucking Rolling Stones and
sure.
Kiss and, you know, and all of this. They fucking out right now. On tour right now.
I talk about it all the time.
When we was kids. Right. Like, why the fuck wouldn't we want that for our own culture to pass down to the youth to say, here, you have something. If you deserve that shot, you deserve that shot. Like,
right. You know, it's funny. I say it every episode. I say this shit. I always talk about how Barry Manilow's out there right now. I use this fucking line all the time. And fucking the people in the, they're not like, yo, Barry's old. They're sitting there loving him. Like, imagine Styles P being that, you know, doing a concert at 70 years old, coming out, I get high.
You know what it is? Hip-hop's so closely related to sports. And sports is a young man's game that it seems like the same. But, at a point in time, like, it is a point in time, like, I don't go to the club and fucking expect to hear what I want to hear.
Yeah.
Like, I go to the club and I know, all right, this is their shit. If I could hear something I like when I'm in this motherfucker, mm-hmm. I take it out of it. Because that reverts back to kind of street principles. That corner is not yours forever.
Sure. Right. And you spoke you know about something before.
That's not yours forever.
I heard you say something like that. You don't judge the youth today because of the golden era hip-hop you came from, because it's not the golden era day anymore.
It's not that day.
So it's a new day.
It's a new day. It's a new day and age. So you can't hold people to your standards all the time. You can hold yourself to your standards. Sure. You got to, whatever standards they are that they're holding themselves to, you can either respect it and fuck with it, or not respect it and not fuck with it. It's pretty much simple. But, like, you know, when I'm in a crib, though, with my son and, like, you know, my personal homies and my brothers, they're starting to share, I'd be like, yo, turn that shit the fuck off. That shit's trash. It's garbage. And then I wouldn't do that, because that's disrespect. That's disrespect, and I don't like to disrespect nobody's art. Like, you know what I mean? Because there's a bunch of people in the world who probably listen to my shit like, what the fuck is he talking about? Why is he talking about that? And, you know, it might not make sense to them. And that's their right, and that's their opinion to have that. So you can't really go knocking people.
That's true.
Because it ain't your shit. Like, there's, you know, I like certain sneakers I like, and then I don't like none of the fucking rest of the sneakers, and then that make me an asshole to walk around all day. Like, look at that guy. He's a dickhead.
Are there any new artists that
suck.
You do like?
I like a lot of new artists. What you mean by new? I like Dave East.
Okay.
That's my babe, bro.
I think
love Dave East.
He's really popping.
I like Don Q. Mm. I like Joey Badass.
He's cool.
I like J. Cole. I like Kendrick. I like Action Bronson. I like my boy Fortez. My boy Chris Rivers.
Mm-hmm.
Chris
my
Rivers
boy Snipes. Yeah,
there's
a lot of talent out there. Like, I like MCs. Like, you know what I mean? And then sometimes I just, as an MC, don't give a fuck about nobody neither, because you got to be in that zone sometimes to say, you know what, fuck what's out, fuck who's out, respect, salute, but fuck them. Like, I'm in the zone, because I think that's what it takes to survive, me personally, in my own
sure.
mind.
Right.
That's what keeps me ticking as an MC. Like,
that's
you know
exactly
what
I was going to ask you, because, like, one thing about you is that you stayed true to being a lyricist. Like, you didn't go commercial or try mm-hmm. to sell out. And I was going to ask you, like, what gave you the courage to do that with everyone, like, transforming into what they think is cool or in the now?
Well, I think it's what you want to leave, how you want to leave, and what you came in it for. I mean, the most exciting thing to me was to be able for somebody to say, yo, he said that shit. Who knows that lifestyle, the background, the neighborhood. That's the ultimate goal. So everything else is like a plus and a minus. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not, everything else is like, I just want to be respected for my craft, because nobody's going to go, yo, you know, when he died, yo, he had fucking 23 Bentleys, or he, like, some people will, but most of it, like, in my eyes, like, you remember great men. You don't, I don't say, yo, Malcolm X, yo, his crib was crazy, or Martin's thing was, JFK had this, or,
right.
you don't fucking say that. You just know who was great, and, you know, Bob Marley was great. You don't
sure.
go fucking looking up
right. well,
his belongings.
His Coogee collection.
I don't, like, you know what I mean? So, you know, I mean, that's just the era I'm from, so I kind of just stick to the craft.
Yeah,
I stick to the art. Like, shit is an art form.
No, it really is.
And when you don't respect it, it's like, you know, I look at it like karate. It's my form of karate, basketball, and a thing. So, I don't know, I like to look at it like, I like to build, work on my craft. So, you know, when the competition come, I'm going to bust that ass. And just to be staying
shape. How does someone of your caliber, like, perfect their craft? Like, most people already think that you are there. Like, how do you get better? Or what
could,
do you do
I mean, you could always,
to, like, play with your mind?
And life. In life in general, besides MCing.
Right.
In life in general, I mean, you could learn something to the day you die. So as long as you can learn, that means you have room to get better.
Yo,
in my eyes.
We're going to go back and forth into different things in this episode because I think like so many people who may know of Styles P, and some may know, some may not know, right? Just like you are like a well-rounded person. Like I'm talking about like some people may not notice, and where I'm going with this is you need to write a book. I know you authored a couple of fictional books.
Mm-hmm. I've definitely authored a fiction book before Invincible.
Yeah. And are you doing more?
Yeah, I got two halfway done. I was really waiting to finish the locks and the music because I just want to sit down. Like when I want to do the author thing, that shit is hard. I respect anybody who could sit down and write anything because that was very hard. Like, you know what I mean? It takes time. It takes energy because when you used to doing some music, is second nature for me. So if you throw the beat on, I'm going to light up. I like the shit. It's going to. Sure. You know, I'm gonna put my soul to work and, you know, my soul gonna do most of the work regardless. But, like, when I was writing a book, you know, I wrote it on my BlackBerry at the time.
Because, shout out to BBM.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I wrote it. I just put it in my notes. Then I would send myself the email, copy, page print.
But what made you, so many people, I mean, this day and age, they write books about their autobiography or they write, you know, books about what has something to do with them. You wrote fictional.
Creative. Mm-hmm. Just want to be creative. I love being creative, man. I got my trifecta is I'll be complete when I, you know, definitely got to do another book. So it's more than one book.
Yeah.
You know, I'm definitely another fiction joint to the joint. So it's more than one book. And people can see it wasn't a fluke.
Most definitely.
And I'm nice at it. Like, you know what I mean? And I got two halfway done. So I'm going to finish the game. And then it also is film. Like, I always want to do music. Books, films, like, you know, I like being creative. I feel like, I guess what you could say rounds me out is the ups and downs in life and wanting to be creative and knowing that, you know, you got to go through a lot of shit to be creative and stay creative and just kind of understand life in general that, you know, it has a lot of shit in it.
You know, for a long time, remember when I was telling you that I relate a lot to you, for a long time, it was hard to stay out of trouble. And I tell people who don't know about that, don't, like, people who don't know what it is to stay out of jail, like, it's just normal for them. Like, I just don't go to jail. Like, what are you talking about? But for me, it was so hard to stay out of jail because I was always, and I remember you telling me before and just, like, we live in a world where sometimes we get blessings. Like, you know how many cases that have done passed me up and then I got in trouble for the stupidest shit?
Yeah.
And I guess what I'm asking you is when do you know that you're, like, done with trying to, like, get in trouble anymore? Because, yo, the last bit I did, I was like, yo, I'm never going back.
I think that's when that hits your head. Like, I think you got to say to yourself, like, with me, more than anything, it was like, yo, I don't believe I don't have my freedom. Like, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. For stupid shit, like, because sometimes anything can happen, and you get in situations where shit could happen, and you could lose your freedom. Yeah. But you want to move the best you can in life to avoid that situation. Sure. But when you do something and you lose your freedom for something you didn't have to do, and it really hits you like, yo, I'm missing my family. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm missing money. I'm just missing breathing. I got somebody telling me to fucking lift my dick, lift my nuts, split my ass cheeks, lift the bottom of my feet, open my mouth.
After a visit,
then I'm smelling scents I don't like. You know what I'm saying? So I'm a realistic person to know I don't want to do this shit again. I don't want to smell no motherfuckers. I don't want nobody telling me what to do. I don't want to. I think it got to come to that point with you, and you got to drop your ego and pride in life to say, you know, I don't want to be in the situations. You got to learn that. You got to learn when to bounce sometimes.
Yeah, and I did. That's why I never went back, man. I'm home 10 plus years. But I will say this. The locked up, like, yo, that shit haunted me, that song, because all my friends had that shit on their ringtone. And whenever I would come home and I would talk some shit, I'd be like, man, fuck y'all. They'd be like, locked up, can't let me. I'm like, yo, motherfuckers make fun of you being away, like saying, you know, just like shit like that. But it's funny because I feel like you spoke to so many people who have been away or were away.
Yeah.
You know, like when you spoke, and we'll go over that later, but like word for word, what you were saying there spoke. It's almost like Kiss. You know, how many, did Kiss do any bids?
Hmm? Kiss do any, been locked up a couple of times. You know why? Because
I don't remember him doing any bids like that.
Mm-mm.
And when I would hear his shit, I'm like, yo, how the fuck did this motherfucker, is he talking to Styles? Yo, because he used to say shit that only jail people would know.
Yeah, I mean, our whole crew, family members, town. Yeah. And, I mean, you know how that shit is.
What was it like being locked up after the fame? Like, were people trying to, like, slide you mixtapes and rap to you while you was in the bathroom?
CDs?
Sometimes I would, like, it would be ciphers and you hear people, like, that shit would annoy me sometimes. Like, when somebody just stand around and just start, like,
yo,
like
they just had a...
Nah, I don't mind that. Like, that's respectable. Like, you know what I'm saying? But, like, when y'all was just chilling and then I come around and then a cipher just started. You mean, like, it's kind of a way... You know, it's always a way to do things with cool thing in class and then a kind of corny, cheesy way to do things.
Motherfuckers were playing dominoes. Like, oh, shit, start a peak coming. Come on.
Did any of the CEOs ever look out for you? Kind of like, because you...
Yeah, I had a couple cool CEOs. Okay. I had a couple... I got moved a lot, though. Like, you know what I'm saying? They would move me a lot because, truthfully, I was smoking a lot. And they really couldn't catch me smoking. And I was just smoking like a fucking chimney. I mean, I always had at least a... Not to brag and not to make no... Because you don't want to be in jail. But
that's
I was
hot,
I was really... I had a bad temper, so I always knew I had to keep, you know, smoke to keep calm. So I would always just have weed in and all of that. And they would know I was smoking. Like, I'm smart, so I would do, like, real smart shit that nobody else was, like, really doing, just, you know, kind of using my nerd power to get over. And it was really working, and they knew it, but they just couldn't catch me, so it was, like, they would get annoyed and just randomly move me, make me pack my shit in the middle of the night and just move me, and, like... And
yo, those days
I had too much juice in a lot of spots.
Yo, you know what, without going full-fledged prison shit, when they would move me in the middle of the night... Like, that was when I knew I never had to come back here. Because, like, yo, I would have a garbage bag with all my shit in it. And then have to relocate and move. And then people wake up. Because I was in dorms sometimes. Yeah. Sometimes I was in cells.
Yeah.
But with the dorms, people look.
Even that, just feeling like you could move your whole life in a garbage bag.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? A big black bag. It's just fucking crazy. And then, to really get into it on a real, real tip, like when you wake up and realize that shit is the slave ship and it's slavery part two, it really fucks your head up because you start understanding that it's way, way deeper than whatever the fuck bravado y'all motherfuckers is thinking about on the corner, whatever stripes you think you're going to get, whatever jacket you think that, however tough you think that's going to make you look, it's really a whole nother... shit going on. That shit is a slave ship, literally, and it's fucked up. Like, you know what I mean? How many people get incarcerated? How many minorities get incarcerated? How much unfair time they get?
Well, what about working? What about the labor?
They working, the labor, the whole shit is just fucked up.
No, Vlad TV, he tweeted something about the prison strike. I'm sure you know about how some prisons are strike. There's inmates right now, not eating. You know, refusing to eat, refusing to do things because of the unhealthiness of the food there. Even the work, like the work labors. But see, the people who've never been away, who don't understand what the slavery that's going on still in there today. Mm-hmm. People don't understand. Like here, I'll give an example. They're paying people
like 7 cents,
5 cents. Like, I made 9 cents a day on my last year there. I was outside clearance. A day, yeah.
That's crazy.
But here's the thing. When I came home, I had like, after 3 years, I think I had like $1.70. You know what I mean? Like working every day. But here's the thing. People will tell you, when you tell somebody that, short-minded people will tell you, like, dude, you got locked up. Like, you know, like, what do you expect? So that means that they're supposed to, like, I pay my time to the state. That's already paying my time. You know, working, at least they should give people a chance, an opportunity to, you know, reform them to come home. You know, reform them to be productive members of society, but they don't want you to because they want you to come back. You understand? I mean, there's so much going on, but there's a prison strike going on. But anyway, you know what? Let's go. Let's bring it back for a second. Let's bring it back. How did you meet Kiss and Sheik? Like, where did
from
that even...
From Yonkers.
Okay.
From Yonkers. I'm from the South Side. Junior high years.
Okay. Okay. School.
Yeah, school.
Yeah. Okay.
School.
And Mary Jane is also from there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's how you guys
DMX
got
too.
The deal. Mm-hmm. Did you know DMX growing up as well?
Mm-hmm. That's Mary, DMX, I mean, we all from Yonkers. Like, that's kind of impossible for us not to know each other. And we used to cipher with X way before any of us thought of getting on. I mean, that was, if you from Yonkers and you rap, you know, you had to go through a lot of shit. Like, you know what I mean? So
did you see X? Did you know what he would be, what he was going to be?
Yeah, X was always dope. X was he was a superstar even then. He was a ghetto superstar.
Yeah.
Because what he was saying was real and he was living his shit. Yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't just, and he was passionate and, you know, he was just a very ill MC. Mm. And rare. Like, you know what I mean? You don't get to see that too often. What
about, are you guys still in contact?
Yeah. That's just great. On tour. It was great being on tour because X was on some dates. He was on a lot of dates.
Oh, that's right. He was on the Bad Boy thing.
Yeah, and it was actually just real, you know, it was nostalgia. It was real great. Dressing room right next to ours. It just
wilding
break
out.
The shit down. Yeah, we drinking, smoking.
And I think that's really cool that you were on tour with the Bad Boy tour because, like, we were just saying how people don't honor those that came before, but I feel like this tour was, like, exactly that. It was, like, the younger generation, like, seeing what we grew up on. Like, I wish I could have seen that every day, all day. Like, I just know that it was so live.
It was really fun. Like, you know what I mean?
They're going to do it again?
I hope so.
Hey, listen, the stadiums look packed.
Yeah, man. It was really dope. It was really dope. You know what I mean? Bad Boy stands for a lot in the golden era, point blank period. Like, you know what I mean? And it's like the Chicago Bulls of rap back then. Like, you can't deny what they've done.
You said it. I heard you say it before. You said that signing to Puff. When Puff was looking at us, regardless of what you guys went through for a little bit, you said when... what else you say? He said that when he was looking to sign you guys,
because
that was like
signing to the Bulls. Yeah, fucking made it. Like we sell dope, work stock jobs, frob shit, sell bass, smoke. We go trying to go to school. Some of us, we just trying to make our way. So now, and you rhyming, and we paying for studio sessions, and you know we've done a lot. We sold fucking tapes in high school, dog.
Yeah.
We sold tapes out of the trunks of car. We was independent in high school before we even fucking made it to the industry. I stole the tapes from my job. We make the tapes. Like, I mean, so when you come from that much work and that much history and that much pain and, you know, that much blood, sweat, and tears and fucking Puffs at your door. And I mean, come on.
Like, how did he even hear about you at that time?
One of the tapes we made in high school. Mm-hmm. And then I told you we made tapes and then we would sell them. And we kept doing it. One of them, Mary was playing it on tour.
Okay.
Puff heard it with Mary, wanted to know who we was. Rough Riders at the time were our managers.
Okay, okay.
You know, they didn't even, they wasn't a label. It was just
like Wadeen, you talking about?
Yeah, D&Y. Yeah. Y managers. They brought us to Puff, got us around there. I remember Puff telling us to spit and we just.
On site?
Yeah, on site. We was on site with it any time. Because that was the time, you know, you had to really be in the streets with your shit. Especially with us being from Yonkers. Like, you know what I mean? So we'll go to a place and nobody really knew who Yonkers dudes was.
Sure, sure. I can see that.
You know, it'd be like everybody else is in the house and you'd be like a Yonkers dude and they fucking looking. And then you just got to know you got to show your ass. And so we was used to like, it'd be funny because we know like sometimes like, you know, we're going to go to this place. And if you ain't extremely nice, you're fucked. We're going to tear you up. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So that's what it used to be.
You guys put Yonkers on the map, man.
Yeah.
But so Puff sees you and the first thing he says is like, yo, spit.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was, I don't remember verbatim, but I know it was us meeting him and spitting. That was the whole purpose of it.
Yeah.
Like, how long after that did you guys get the deal?
It wasn't too long. Right. It was pretty much right after that. It was kind of life changed.
I respect you so much from that point. Like, this generation is like everything's instant gratification. Everything is right now, in the now. And you guys really had to like put in that work. Yeah. And
that's
like,
technology, though.
Yeah.
I don't think it's not this generation's fault because we didn't have Instagram, we didn't have Twitter, we didn't have 4K, 4G, 3G, 2G.
But it still gives like, them a sense of entitlement. Yeah. They still have like an entitlement.
It does, but you got to work. But that's why, you know, the one thing is though, you could come out and be great for a moment. Like, you know what I'm saying? But work stands the test of time.
Right.
Like,
longevity,
you know what I'm saying? You can't say you great without the work backing it up for a long time. So a lot of people come out the box and it's great and it's a good looking, it's big looking and they're super dope. But through the next few years, you'll see if that's meant to be or if it's not meant to be. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I don't really knock it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Because I say it's a different day and age. Like, you know what I'm saying? Then you do have those who do pay super homage. Like, you know what I'm saying? There's a lot of, and hip hop is out there. We just really, this, I think this argument goes because mainstream gets the most attention.
Right.
If you're a hip hop head like this, when I was coming up, the thrill in that shit was me coming around and my friends finding something before they found it. Mm. You fucking didn't hear this shit. Listen to this shit.
Check this out.
New Cool G, whatever was on Stretch, whatever was on Molly Mall, Red Alert,
DJ Magic.
Magic, Chuck Chill Out, you know, all these eras, you know, I didn't mention in chronological order, right, but all of this shit meant a lot. If you could, even up to Clue, Ron G, Doo-Wop, you know what I'm saying, SNS, Slay,
Capri,
or if you could find something that nobody got, or you get the tape first and before all of that, that's fucking gold. Like, you was gold in the hood. Like, I couldn't wait to pull up and know the fucking verse before anybody knew the verse. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I know this shit. So by the time the argument come, I already deciphered everything he said. And now I can say, when you say your MC is better and he says such and such, I can say my man's better. He said this and that. You know what I mean? I think that's what's missing. Because what's missing is if you ask all these kids, yo, all right, who's your fucking, your favorite artist and shit? All right, what's this random? Give me the second verse on a random song.
Mm.
See if you get it.
Yeah.
Ball for ball. I think that's the difference. Like, we came up in an era, like, they want to, I don't knock it, they want to party, they want to get high, and they don't give a fuck what the fucking record is saying. They mumbling.
They mumbling.
They whining. They humming. They doing all kind of shit. But the beat's knocking. It's a catchy hook. You could dance to it.
It's lit.
It's a night vibe. It's like lit. I mean, you know, so I get it. But when we was coming up, it was more like an education, you know what I mean? Like, that was kind of our education. When you know, Chuck D, KRS, and them was more than just MCs to me. I was getting lessons.
Mm-hmm. Mentors.
From Rakim, Chuck D, KRS. These are things I'm learning how to apply to my own life. These are things that's making me want to acquire knowledge outside of school. These are things that's making me want to have knowledge yourself, like, Tribe Called Quest kind of made you say, oh, shit, you could just be regular cool on some hip-hop shit and be fresh, too. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was good. Like, there's so much shit in that era and before we got there that was so, that much, it made us who we were. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like a school. To me, it's like a school. Those are our forefathers, our masters. Like, you know what I'm saying? I could tell you I studied KRS. I studied Rakim. I studied... I'm a black belt in these shits. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm a black belt.
Coming up, these were inspirations to you.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, these are my forefathers. They paved
the way.
EPMD and them, they paved our fucking way. We can't, we can't do an In and Out without thinking of EPMD and Slick Rick and Dougie on the thing. Yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? So these are, you know, running.
And the moves they made. I mean, we had...
This shit paved our fucking way.
We had Scoob from Das FX on a couple episodes ago. I mean, EPMD, you spotted them at a fucking contest.
You can't look at somebody and that made you want to do what you're doing and then get there and shit on them. It's fucking retarded.
Yeah.
It's fucking retarded, because who are you inspired by? You had to be inspired by somebody.
Mm-hmm.
You had to be inspired by somebody. That's just plain and fucking simple.
One thing I think about is most artists, you know, from my age, our age, they were inspired by people like, you know, the forefathers.
Yeah.
When you think about a Chuck D, or you think about a KRS, or you think about, you know, Rakim, you know. But now, the younger generation, there's a lot of people like yourself who are very open to the younger generation. You ain't hating. You listen, as long as they respect the craft.
Yeah.
But if you think about it, 25 years, 30 years from now, they're going to be inspired by the people who we may not even, like, what could hip-hop be? Like, you know what I mean?
Well, it's going to always be some real shit, because you got to understand. You got to look at it for, you got to really look at the scope sometimes of the things. Like when people was complaining about bullshit music and all of this and all of that, you can't, if you like the kid, even a kid who wants to just fucking swag out and get lit and turn up and do all of that shit, J. Cole and Kendrick still tapped into something on the motherfuckers, and Joey, they still tapped in, because it's still the soul need that shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you could fucking be around dummies all day you want, but you still need to go home and get that jewel from your mom, your pops, big bro, or something. Like, you know what I'm saying? You could be the fucking biggest knucklehead in the world. You could be the stone coldest gangster motherfucker in the world. you still want that advice and that big brotherly love from OG who already did it before you did it.
Yeah.
Whether you want to mention it or not, because you might want to knock his head off because you want to take him off the block.
Yeah.
But if he's cool enough, you know somebody who's cool like that, you still want to pick up them jewels. Like, you know what I'm saying? Everybody looking for something.
Now, there's always a big brother that I feel helped you, whether he was related to you or not. You know what I mean? I think like...
That's hip-hop, period. That's what hip-hop's supposed to do.
Yeah.
I think, you know, and that's what I think, for me, that's what, in a lot of my generation, that's what hip-hop was. It was a father, brother, uncle, best friend. Like, you know what I'm saying? It was all kind of shit for dudes because it gave you a reason to have hope. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It gave you a shot at the dream. That's why I really can't be mad at the young kids. I want them to live the dream. I want them to succeed. I want you to eat. I want you to milk this shit for what it's motherfucking worth and move on. And take your money and move on and do whatever you got to do. Or just have fucking fun and spend it. Whatever the fuck you want to do. You know what I mean? Yeah. You might just want to spend your shit all and buy incense and sand bottles and fucking...
And Fanta leaf
and pray and shit. That's cool, too.
But you're doing some smart things with your money. Like, you're opening up juice bars and investing it in things that are going to... Yeah.
He's an entrepreneur.
Something that's going to, like, reap the benefits for years to come. What made you want to do that? And why a juice bar and not something else?
For me, balance.
Did you start the juice bar? You started that like 4 years ago, not 5 years ago?
Like 6 years ago, but nah, I've been juicing for longer than my partner. I used to just visit a juice bar. You could look like back on a lot of my old DVDs. I used to go to a joint called Fruits of Life in
Harlem
on 125th.
I like that.
Between Park and Madison. That was my spot, and I just lost so much weight, and I had a lot of issues that I got rid of, like from just being healthy. And besides that, it was a time in my life where I just wanted to fucking kill the world. Like, you know what I'm saying? I felt like I was willing to do it if they fucking tempted me. And it was like I knew that wasn't the way to be. Like, you know what I'm saying? You know when you know you're smart, but your temper is getting the best of you and your ego and your pride is making you really wild. And, you know, I'm a short dude. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I was big on, like, okay, you fuck around if you want. You're going to remember me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm going to make you pay. And they're going to hear about it, and my shit is going to ring. And I think you just, once you're in that mode, it's, like, hard to get the fuck out of it. Like, it's just hard to say. You know, like, it's hard to find that pull yourself out of it. And it's like, what the fuck?
How the fuck did you pull yourself out of it?
He juiced.
I juiced, and I just knew I wanted to get out of it. I just started putting myself in a better position. Like, I started saying I'm going to take myself out of certain situations. I kind of learned how to bounce out on a bad vibe. I learned it to, like... It's hard to, we can't have a problem if we don't engage. Like,
sure.
I don't got to fucking say shit to you. As long as you don't touch me or something, like, so I know how far to go with conversations, who, like, I pretty just use my intuition, my judgment, my energy, the other person's energy, and how I'm feeling. Like, you know what I'm saying? And I just try to think of the fam, try to think of what I'm trying to do in life. And then I try to think of the fucking pain all of that shit causes. Like, that shit is a fucking headache. Like,
not only
that's
to
why
you.
I try to tell people all the time. Like, I'm a preaching motherfucker because I really know what it is. Like, so a lot of these kids, they come and they hear rap and they hear this shit and they hear a nigga talking like he really did some of the shit he didn't do that he's talking about somebody else doing. Mm-hmm. And they don't really know the consequences involved. Like, you know what I'm saying? And it's cool because I feel like through music you should be able to express yourself. Because if I want to kill 1,000 motherfuckers, let me kill them on this song. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I also feel like I don't want to, you know, but if I want to make peace, I want to make peace too. I try to be balanced with my shit. But I feel, you know, music is to express yourself. So I think it's just about fucking doing that.
Yeah. Now with Juices for Life, that started, the first store started in Yonkers. Right?
Castle Hill.
Okay, Castle Hill in the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Castle Hill.
And then the next one started in Yonkers?
Yonkers, then we went to Tremont, and then we in Brooklyn.
So now you opened the one with you opened MV in Brooklyn. And,
Yonkers, Kiss is my partner.
Okay.
In Brooklyn, Angela Yee and Envy's my partner.
Okay, nice. You know what I mean? Yeah, she spoke about that when she was on
I tried to...
How'd that happen?
We try to build something, man. I think, like, this shit is important. Not just the juice. It's bigger than the juice. It's really about a lifestyle, you know, for our future. You know what I mean? Like, to be, I hate to fucking sit here and preach, but you gotta really look about how people are fed. Like, you know what I'm saying? What's in the supermarkets, the laws they pass, what you eat. I eat plants. I'm not telling everybody to be a vegan. I'm not even a vegan. I just say I eat plants. I live a plant-based lifestyle. I still wear leather. I just don't eat meat, right. Chicken, byproducts.
You stop eating?
Huh?
Not even seafood?
Nah, no seafood, nothing. I just eat all plants. But I just think when you, whatever you eat, pick the healthiest option. Because, like, it's like, all right, I got on this fucking fresh-ass shirt and pants. I know where they from. I got on this fresh-ass watch chain. I spent money. I know where it's from. I know where my car is from. I know where my gear is from. I know where my drawers is from.
But
if I ask you where the fuck was last night's chicken from, and you go, all right, nah, it was from Chipotle. And I'd be like, okay, but what state? And you'd be like, I don't fucking know. And then I'd be like, okay, was it male or female? You're going to tell me you don't know. Was it grass-fed? Was it shot on drugs? You're going to tell me you don't know. But you know what you're putting on your body, but you don't know what you're putting in your body. It's fucking backwards to me.
Right.
And we raising our kids like this, and the next generation and the next generation, and we used to eat fast food, and we don't fucking got insurance. We don't go to the doctor. So we got to prevent. Like, I'm not with really going to the doctor, and most niggas don't got insurance. So you got to figure out if that shit ain't going to work, what's the fucking next best step? And it ain't going to get fried chicken and greasy food every fucking day. And if you're all going to get chicken, go to fucking Whole Foods, Trader Joe's, a natural market, a halal spot. At least have the information on it. Get you some fucking coconut oil, olive oil. Cook it yourself.
Yeah. Yo, you need to
if we don't think like this, like as a people, like and I feel like it's my priority as a gangster because I know gangsters don't think like this.
Right.
Like, well, a lot do. It's like you want to be the if something happened today, like, right, and I come in a spot. When I walk in a spot, most of the time, I'm gonna walk in by myself or with light numbers. Now, if something happens, I want to be the best me I could be. That means if I got to shake, if I got to rumble, I need to be able to breathe. If I got to run out this motherfucker, I need to be able to breathe. Now, if it's another situation, that ain't such a violent situation. I'm with my family, nice suburban day. You know, you're a casual guy. You're by the bridge. It's jam-packed traffic. Boom, some shit happens. Shit is blowing up. You by the bridge. How the fuck far can you walk?
Right.
You know, can you walk far? Like, are you good for a mile, 2 miles, 5 miles, 10 miles? Do you know that? Do you know your limit? Do you know your limit and when you go? I mean, I think to me personally, maybe because I'm stoned a lot of the times and I like to think of a lot of other shit that I may be thinking far out. But I feel this shit is important because I don't want to be caught up in a situation and not be the best me I could be.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, and that shit really happens to you because I was like, say, for instance, I was on tour.
Okay.
On tour, I woke up, I had my regimen every day. I juiced, made my soups, took my veggies, worked out, tried to get as much sleep as I can. I got off tour. Got back to work, barely sleeping, drinking a little too much, you know what I'm saying? Not eating as many greens as I normally eat, eating more salt, more sugar. Now my toe is inflamed. Never happened to me before, but I know that's because of my diet. I ain't take my vitamins. Well, it could be because I know it's an inflamed toe. I think it is. Because they hurt like a motherfucker.
They call it the rich man disease.
Yeah.
My dad has that.
But then, like, so you get a lot of information. So now I'm talking to the doctor. He's like, you got to watch everything you eat. Because now you eat a plant-based diet. Some greens you eating. Some sugars you eating. Could be causing that. Could not be. You could be. So now most people who get it, because now I know most people who get it, who have it, just be like, I got gout and I got gout forever. Nah, find out all the fucking remedies. Go to the store. Go to the Yardi store, get the doctor's information, go to another doctor's information, and get to working. Like I had bad eczema before. I had so many, I had a few ailments.
Right.
I had cyanitis.
What's that?
It's like when your sinus just keep dripping, and then you end up keep getting sick and keep getting a fever. And I kept going to the doctor, and the doctor didn't work. You know what I said? I'm going to figure this shit out myself. I'm going to start taking the right remedies to heal myself. Because certain things, you find out something wrong with you, you panic. Go, oh, shit, I'm fucked. This and that, you don't know what to do. Shit could be fucked up with you. You got to find out what's wrong with you. Like,
Like, you ever have that miso soup from the fucking?
I can't. I had the latest miso soup I had was at a vegan spot, because miso soup most likely has a tofu. If you ain't into vegan, it has tofu in it, but a lot of people use fish broth. Mm. Oh. This is why you got to ask when you order stuff.
Yeah.
Like, so a lot of things you order, it don't say a lot of the shit that's in it, but it's in it. Like, you might get yellow rice, you don't know chicken stock's in it,
right,
most of the
that's
time.
True.
Now, if you don't eat chicken, and you thinking you going out eating yellow rice, you eating fucking chicken every day because there's mad chicken stock in it.
I worked at a restaurant, and, like, people used to come and order the chicken. Like, these people came in, they ordered the chicken not knowing that it was a chicken meatball, but it had pork in it. And
yeah,
accidentally ate
that's
it,
what I'm
and
saying.
They was
that
like,
shit is, that
they
shit
was
is
Muslim,
crazy.
And they, like, was ready to sue.
That shit is crazy because, I mean, I just say, just be the best you could be, because you got a whole bunch of people watching you. Mm-hmm. It's not even with just food. It's just in life. Like, if you, let's take food out the picture, because it might sound a little preachy. That's like if you see somebody, like, you got a bunch of homies, a bunch of friends, y'all on the corner on the stoop every day, you drinking, you fucking up, then you see the one homie who gets a good job, focuses, do what he got to do, start pulling his shit together. People become influenced by that, whether they say it or not. Some people, you know, they might hate on it. That's just because they don't know how to show it love.
Mm-hmm.
But people become influenced by what you do. So when you bring a positive habit home, like, you know what I'm saying, it spreads to the seed. It spreads to the elders. It spreads to the family. It spreads to the homies. Now you have, you know, one good person turns to five. Five turns to 10. 10 turns to 20. Now we got a supporting cast of each other, a unit. Now we could grow, because I think this, you know, I think this, this health wave is something we as a people got to really take serious.
That's true.
Because you think better. The better you feel, the better you think.
And it's true, because it even goes back to slavery. Like, they used to give us the worst food.
Yeah.
It's just that we made it taste good.
Yeah, and that don't mean you're supposed to
you.
Keep fucking eating
right.
it 70 years later.
Right.
Like, what the fuck? Like, right. It's over.
That's even like we spoke about, that's like prisons. But you know what? Before we take a break, with Puff, you know, when he signed you and stuff like that, I know that you guys went through your ups and downs. And I know that, you know, obviously there was that issue there with the contract and stuff. But, you know, I remember how much Holly you spoke about, dude, when he gave you your publishing back. Like,
yeah.
That was kind of like, did you expect him to even do that? Without a fucking, like...
I mean, I put it on God's hands. I put that one in God's hands. I didn't expect him to do it, but I expected God to make it happen, and he didn't have to do it. So when he did it, I was very grateful, very thankful. You know what it is? Like, I had to really... This is what a lot of people don't really understand, and this was the crazy part. Our contract was like the basic industry
contract.
Like the standard contract. Just being smart kind of makes you say, these are fucked up numbers. Like, you know, this number's, wait a minute, whoa. Like, you know what I mean? So when you do common multiplication and you come from the hood, like, and you from flipping work and then you flipping tapes and, you know, I know 10 times 10 is 100 when
right.
I flip work. 10 times 10 is not 100 when I'm flipping this tape, and I don't fucking get it. Like, you know what I mean? Fuck the contract. Like, you know, yo, did y'all contract? Fuck the contract. Lawyer, you're fired. Fuck that shit. Fuck that contract. Fuck the industry. Fuck how it go. It's room for change. Everything's meant to be broken. We was rebels. We came in on a rebel note, so it kind of made us, like, you know what I'm saying? And Big had passed, so we was emotional.
Because
Big was like our bigger brother who always kept us, you know, because at the time, Puff was flamboyant. So, you know, when you're from the hood and the nigga's extra flamboyant,
sure.
And shit is kind of like, you like, you know, so Big was that kind of liaison and always used to school us to a lot of shit. And, like, you know what I'm saying? So when he passed, it was kind of like, Big crossed, it was like, oh, shit.
And
it was just... It went sour, and you know it was meant to be though.
Did Puff ever have that? Did you ever have that talk afterwards? I mean, obviously you're on the Bad Boy reunion.
Yeah, we had
me.
Plenty talks.
And
had plenty talks.
Buried that hatchet. No.
Yeah, you ain't hit. What was his last project? I forget the name. I'm high right now.
Who?
Puff's last project.
I don't even know. I don't even know his last project.
You should. Money Making Mitch. I'm not.
Yeah, that's what it was.
I'm fucking
that's
high.
That's what it
right
was.
Now.
No, that's what it was.
Yeah, you better look at the writing credits.
Yeah. Okay, what are you writing there?
Shit,
SP
a lot.
The Ghost.
I wrote a lot in that shit.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've been squashed that, though.
No,
as
no,
a
I know that's been squashed.
You know what people got to understand about the industry? Like, that shit is, whatever industry beef is nowhere near
Real beef.
What's considered real beef in the real street, even if it's beef most of the time. Because you got to understand, if, like, a lot of dudes, if you have beef in the street, you got beef in the street with somebody who most likely sometimes could live by you. Mm. You either got to handle that, rectify it, or know how to move accordingly. So somebody who you was getting money with, having a good time with, and, you know, you have discrepancies with, and it, you know,
yeah,
that's not as serious as somebody who was trying to take blood from you. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Nah, most definitely.
I think people always misconstrued the industry beef and street beef.
But that's,
I don't
the
really
difference.
Look at
the people don't know how to differentiate, like, real life from music. Like,
no, because media
just don't. Yeah,
it's media.
Yeah,
media,
and
media,
you got,
does that.
Even reality TV versus reality, they just don't know the difference.
Yeah, yeah. And you got to think about it. Like I said, you know, Puff gave back the publishing, which is a hell of a fucking thing, you know, for somebody to do. But internet, you know what? Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back. Smoke up, you know, light up, roll up. How are you smoking these days, stuff?
Fronto.
And get
hemp paper.
Grab your hemp paper and Fronto leaf.
And a green juice.
Yeah.
Don't go nowhere. We'll be right back. Cheer.
Ow. I'm politicking with this chicken, and she's using the bevel blade, the only system clinically proven to prevent bumps, bruises, and ingrown hairs.
Listen, internet, your first month free on your bevel membership. Want to find out how to get that? Head on over to getbevel.com/Pete, okay? Getbevel.com/Pete will get your first month free on your bevel membership. If you don't know about bevel, head on over there, check it out. If you do, you already know what it is. And just get your free membership over there at getbevel.com/Pete.
And tell them the dynamic duo sent you. Thanks
That's
to
great.
Us.
Mm-hmm. Now let's get back to the show. Cheer.
Cheer, cheer.
Internets, and we're back. Back from a smoke break. Fuck
That's
that.
What you going to do?
No, you need a smoke break anyway.
The internet needed a smoke break.
Well, you never know what the internet need, most definitely. But sometimes people need a smoke break. This is 2016, man. If listen.
I'll take a smoke break in the middle of a show, you know that?
Really?
Yeah, I've done it before.
When you first started out, like, did they tell you to, like, hide your, like, vices, like, or was it always open?
I think I got a reputation for not really giving a fuck is how the whole
you do.
Thing came, you know? I go somewhere, I got to smoke, man. I had to back then. You know, you're making music. It was like music. Like, I mean, it's music. As far as I'm concerned, Bob Marley, you know, Big.
Yeah, I mean,
Snoop.
Listen, they got to get with the fucking times, man.
I'm a hippie, man.
Listen, they got to get with the fucking times. Listen, let's go. I want to take it back to Mary J. When you spoke about going to school with Mary J.
I ain't go to school with Mary.
No. Well, she was in the neighborhood.
Yeah,
right?
she from my neighborhood. Yeah.
I remember you saying that she used to like sing in the park.
Mm-hmm.
Or she used to sing like
everywhere.
Raw. Like sing like, but everywhere. With no microphone or nothing.
Nothing.
So you saw that talent from jump.
Yeah, for sure.
So you knew that was going
to
be.
I used to go to Mary crib.
Yeah?
She lived upstairs from my cousin, and it was close, so I used to. I always knew Mary.
How do you feel about everything that's going on with her and the divorce, and are you cool with Ken do? Like?
I don't know. I don't get into people's marital affairs and their love lives, and I try to be honest with you. As far as comes with artists, like if they don't approach me with it, I want to talk personally. I don't go by anything that the media is saying about them and them because that's their personal business. Like
sure.
So, I know I wouldn't want nobody just fucking randomly giving their opinion on my life, sure. Whether I'm a celebrity or a non-celebrity, because you don't really know what goes on behind closed doors. I just wish the most happiness for Mary.
How come we never had like a Locks Mary like single like?
Time. I don't know. They got kisses on some with Mary. We got we on a Mary joint. It wasn't a single.
Right.
But we
like
on
I mean, like
we definitely on an album.
Right.
We definitely on an album. I know that for a fact.
Mary, DMX. Yo, I remember
like a year, right? That would be hot. Y'all should still do that.
I remember nice. DMX. Weren't you away with DMX?
Yeah, me and DMX.
Didn't he cypher? Remember he told me that
DMX was in the county.
Tell the internet about that story.
This is before rap. This is like when I'm going to say I'm 18 or 19.
Okay.
In the county. I'm in the pen. I get to the pen. I'm there a few days. And the pen is like A block, B block, C block, D block.
Cheer.
F block. So I lived on D block, of course.
Yep.
I stayed on D block. Had a, you know, my cell was there on D block. And I remember X coming to get me one day, like, yo, seeing him, he like, yo, you in the pen? You in the pen, my nigga? I'm like, yeah, I'm in here now. This nigga came and got me one day, like, yo, come on. Got some niggas to take care of. I'm like, where the fuck are we going? Like, he like, you on point? You ready, my nigga? I'm like, yeah, I'm good, my nigga. What's up? He brings me upstairs. This nigga got a drummer lined up.
What?
With 20, like, at least 15 to 20 niggas that rap. I'm like, yo, this nigga's fucking crazy, bro. This nigga's crazy.
Yeah, the county cypher.
We melted niggas, too.
Yeah, that's crazy. I can imagine.
We told niggas out the frame. Word.
I can imagine.
I feel like these new artists don't have that confidence to, like, try to take that on. Like, instead of them welcoming that, they'll try to say shit like, oh, we don't rap over those old beats, or we don't do that anymore.
I mean, times change, you know what I'm saying?
I think it's a fear, and I think that most people are
if you don't got bars, you should chill out. I think it's a respect of not. I think some people respect that they don't have the capability to do that in an effective way, so they fall back, but they just don't say it that way.
Right.
You know what I mean? Nobody wants to cop out there. I'm not ready for that.
Sure, nigga.
Especially when you get a check and you get money and you're famous and you know, and you don't want to be like, you know, that's a good playoff to be like, I ain't into that no more.
Right.
Because even, like, in our days, that, like, when it, because when you started getting money and you got in the industry, you wasn't trying to revert back to just being outside and being in competition with people who didn't even deserve to be in your lane. But you still wanted to flex your shit on the rest of the industry. That's where the mixtape shits came in. Because you know if you was on a mixtape, you know who else was going to be on that mixtape. So you know, this ain't got shit to do with an album. This shit ain't got to do with a check
or
money. This shit got to do with street credibility and fucking props. And we're going to fucking lace your shit, and we're going to eat you when this fucking mixtape come out. And that's what it was about. That kind of went to that. Like, you know what I'm saying? Instead of everybody, because we all came from, whoever was in the game at that time came from rapping from corners and ciphering and battling and all of that shit. So it's kind of like you want to step it up and take it on a bigger scale where more people get to view your shit, too. I mean, even when it was more like listen, but, you know, hear your shit.
Yo, let's break down some of the songs. I mean, there's so many tracks that you created. I mean, so much music that you made. Yeah. I mean, even I look at D-Block. I look at something like D-Block. I look at The Locks. I look at somebody like just rough, rugged, raw, authentic, organic. Yeah. You know, all that shit. Everything I loved, everything, I mean, shit, y'all may have made me catch a case, but it's all good. It's all good. It's all good. But I want to break down some of the songs you, like, maybe give me a backstory pause on some of the things that.
Dude, please don't say pause when you're with me or no homie.
I know.
You don't got to say that. I'm not thinking of dick, and hopefully you're not. If I am thinking of dick, it's my own dick.
Yes, son, you better be thinking of that.
That's it.
But give me the backstory on I Get High, you know? How did that even happen?
For me, getting high all the time and having a reputation for always lighting up, always having weed.
So you go
in the studio. Swish just makes.
Where did Akon come?
Akon wasn't on I Get High.
No, not.
Oh,
not I Get High. I mean, Locked Up. I'm talking about weed. So forget about it. Now you got me all fucking. See, you got me in the smoke room.
No, you said the wrong thing. Yeah.
You got
He's
me in the smoke room.
Yeah.
You got me all fucked up.
He got a contact. That's what he
was right.
I knew he was
like,
sitting too close.
Yeah,
it's that Girl Scout cookies and all in his nostrils.
Motherfucker, man. But it's okay. I Get High.
No, with Akon.
I Get High. Swiss did I Get High.
Okay.
Swiss produced it for me. He just said, I got something for you that fits you. And the thing is right up your alley. And that was it.
And you knew it was a hit right from you heard it?
No. I didn't, actually. I just know I liked it. I just know I had a fond love for it.
Sure, like, you know, I can imagine. Yeah.
It was right up my alley. So,
and to date, that has to be probably the most radio spins, right? No, maybe.
Definitely, I would say.
And what about even like the movie Soul Plane? How does something like that happen?
I guess. Actually, Snoop plugged that in.
Oh, really?
Yep. Snoop. That's on Snoop right there. Snoop held the brother down with that one.
Okay.
It was actually Snoop's shit. And What's a better song to light up to than that shit?
That's true.
Makes sense to
you know
that.
What I mean?
So you still get money off of that song?
Yeah.
Right, because of like publishing.
That song, yeah.
Right, that's hot.
Well, now what about Locked Up? Now let's get to the right person.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well, they knew I was coming off a bid. Super Mario, my man Super Mario plugged that.
Shout out to Super Mario.
Shout out to Super Mario plugged that shit. I was off a bid. I was chilling. I was working. I think I was working on a mixtape or album or doing some kind of shit like that. And Mario was like, I got a bag. You know.
Yeah. Yo, you know what song I want to know?
Bag. It wasn't the bag. It was the brown paper bag. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, that's dope. Then when I heard the song, I was like, no fucking way. Like, you know what I mean? No way. And I said, I can't wait to do
this. So where did
one.
How did who got how did Akon?
Super Mario plugged it up.
Yeah.
He hooked it up. It's all on. That was on Super Mario.
Yo, let me tell you something. I have a love hate relationship with that song. Love hate relationship because from being in the joint, you know, just even the lyrics are talking about like, you know, I don't want to be here. You know, the clothes are, you know, like orange. The food is garbage. You know,
it's a fucked up situation.
But you know, definitely a classic. You know, definitely something that you know, I mean, has stood the test of time. What about BMF, Born Money Fast with Ross? How did he reach out to you? How did that even happen?
Yeah, I forgot where we was. We were somewhere. We was in a couple places together, and we always just chop it up, kick it, and he had a joint for me to hop on. He sent it.
Yeah, I mean that was a big song.
Yeah, he sent it, and I just I did the. I actually didn't know. I sent it like a 24, just on a blank beat, like you know what I mean. He sent me the beat. I didn't know it was gonna be there. I didn't hear him. I didn't hear the hook. I ain't know shit. And I remember I was outside one day in the hood, and I was downtown, and then I was in my, I was just rolling, and I kept everybody go, yo, that shit is crazy. But I didn't know what the fuck nobody was talking about, because I was on the move the whole day. Like, they're like, yo, that shit is crazy, that shit is crazy. And I'm like, all right, just all right, I'm thinking, you know, whatever. And then later on, my man hit me like, yo, that shit you did with Ross is really going crazy. Like, that shit is getting a lot of spins all over. And I was like, I couldn't really remember because I just remember doing the verse. I never heard the hook in the thing. Like, so when I heard it, I was like, oh shit. Like, you know what I'm saying?
That's a lot of respect, I feel like, because that song, you know, does it, when I hear Styles P on it, you know, it fits it, but he could have picked so many other people.
Yeah.
You know, and for him to pick you, I mean, do you guys just have respect level, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, just your artistry and well.
Yeah. Or
lyricism.
Ross is a real student in the game. Like, you know what I'm saying? I really respect how he goes about handling his craft. Like, you know what I mean? He's a craftsman in my eye, for sure. He's definitely an ill lyricist. But I think he pays attention to a lot of history and a lot of MC shit. He has to, for the way he deliver his body of work. As an MC, I could tell that, you know, from listening. You could tell who really respects the craft and studies it, and then, you know, who's just doing what they do.
Sure.
So, you know, and he always speaks on artists that he respects in a way where you could tell he respects the craft. Yeah. So, you know, I always salute that.
Yeah, no, most definitely. What about Jenny from the Block? Jenny from the fucking Block.
Yeah, J-Lo, shout out to J-Lo.
Who the fuck would have fucking ever expected that?
J-Lo is the coolest.
How was that, man, at that time?
It was cool. Yeah. J-Lo is really cool. J-Lo is really, really good.
Smell good, too.
You was cool with her when she was with Puff?
Yeah, I was cool.
Is that how you met her? No, how did you?
No, Jenny from the Block was probably after that, no?
Yeah, that was way after that.
What was the introduction to her?
I met her years before that.
She was a fly girl?
Nah, not that early. It wasn't that early, but I had met her, I can't exactly remember where. I actually want to say, this is crazy, I think it was a Keenan Ivy Wayne show.
See?
Some shit like that. I wasn't in Living Color. The Keenan Ivy Wayne show.
But like the fact that
no, remember he had a show?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So it had to, I think it was around that time.
How'd that track come about? Like, should they just reach out to you? And
I want to say, I'm high.
It's okay. Damn. You're always
I
want to
say Prince Monkey D.
Really?
I believe Prince Monkey D. Shout I want to say
Prince Monkey
that.
D. Shout out to him.
What was it just like creating those Rough Rider compilation albums? Like, those were, like, some of the illest, beautiful. Like, yo, like, that, those beautiful. Are masterpieces. Yeah, and to get was, all of was, those.
It was good because, personally, like, I want to say for us, like, even with Mace, before Mace was on, Mace used to, you know, cypher with us, too. And, yeah, when he was murdered, Mace used to be up in the lab. This is before any of us made it, like, you know what I mean? From the thing. So, to take that energy, you know, from the, from coming from where we came from to know we making it and now we got an outlet to display it on, like, you know what I mean? Right. We was just really being raw about our music. And plus, rap was so thick in competition at that time, like, you know what I mean? You want to make sure you got a sound where people could respect and say, you know, I respect that body of work amidst all this other talent that's out here.
I love it.
Yeah. What about Well, always loved Big Papa. Like, how did that even come about through a time when he passed?
That was something we had to do. That was just one we had to. But listen,
I really, no disrespect to Puff, I love missing you. But I really love, we'll always love Big Papa. I really
he did felt, missing you because we did. We kind of inspired him.
Y'all showed him that before you dropped it?
Yeah.
What they think about it?
He did the video. We had the song. We didn't have the video done. Like, we just, on us, like, Big was our big brother. He schooled us to a lot. He treated us with open arms. He was the most classy G, I want to say, I've ever had the chance to encounter.
And you always spoke about, I always heard you always. Yeah. Speak about how funny he was.
He's very funny. Very funny.
And
very
some
charming,
don't
very,
know that.
Yeah, he had a lot of charisma, a lot of charm, a lot of character. And he would treat your friend like it was you. You know what I mean? So to me, that meant a lot. So and he schooled us to a lot of shit. So, you know, we owed him that. Yeah. We felt like we owed him that.
That's dope that he did that because I don't do that. Like, I don't treat your friend. I don't. I'm not. Like, I don't even. I might not even want to meet your friend.
Nah,
like,
but that. Yeah. We'll always love Big Papa, man. I felt like it spoke to the heart, man. Mm-hmm. You know, I really like. You know, being from Brooklyn, I always felt like, you know, it was forever big. And you know.
Forever big, always.
And you know.
Frank White, baby.
Yeah, I mean, look, for a person, first of all, for a person who, his name is Biggie.
Yeah.
Forget about Christopher Wallace.
Mm-hmm.
Then renames himself Frank White.
Frank White, baby.
I mean, what better.
You can't beat that.
No, you can never. But you know what? That. What on the song, too, All About the Benjamins. Now, a lot of people don't realize you ain't on it.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, I'm on in the spirit. My brother's on
it. No. But
yeah,
what I'm saying is.
I ain't got no verse on that, no.
I've heard stories. I mean, internet's heard stories about Missy Elliott where he was running that. What exactly happened with that shit?
I just didn't make the verse. Yeah. I didn't make the cut. Puff took my part. That's what happened in all actuality.
Yeah.
Puff got my part.
And being somebody who, you know, is a Sag, fellow Sag,
yeah.
And we speak our mind, that didn't bother you at all?
No, it actually didn't because. They didn't like. I don't think none of us liked the Benjamins when it was presented to us.
Most definitely.
Like, you know what I'm saying? I didn't. I wasn't really crazy about the beat. I thought it was dope, but I wasn't really crazy about it. And when you like, I think what separates the Locks from everyone else is we take a win as a win, whether it's one, two, or three, or whatever it was. I use it to motivate me or drive me. I can't be mad at my brothers. Like, you know what I'm saying? Who I'm gonna be mad at, Sheik or Kiss?
Yeah.
I ain't gonna be mad at Puff. Fuck it. He's on the song doing what he gotta do. And it's cool. You show support. That's what the team's about. And I think, you know, you gotta understand it gotta be loyalty above anything else. Like, you know what I'm saying? You gotta be that above anything else when it comes to rocking with your homies because those kind of feelings, if you feed into that, that's why groups happen to break up.
All the time, all day long.
Personal feelings, money, shit like that. I think you got to keep that out. You know, you got to know the end goal. The end goal is us three eating, you know, doing what we got to do. So I ain't got the time to have a bitch nigga feeling.
That's an amazing way to look at it. You know, sometimes I tell people, too, like, success is, applauding others even if you're not even there yet.
Yeah.
And you know, the way you're saying that is something bigger than... many people understand.
Yeah.
And sometimes I think that when we have like this ego, you know, or we have like this thing, sometimes we let that shit get in the way where it's like,
for sure,
you like some people may feel that kiss or and I don't mean them in general. I'm just speaking in general.
Yeah.
But some people may feel like, nah, if I ain't on this shit, y'all shouldn't be, y'all should jump off and be like, fuck them. People think like that these days.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's a bad way of thinking, though. Because you want to, I mean, it's strength in numbers.
Yeah.
If you got to buy one, somebody you came in with them as a, you know, and especially as men, you want to, and women, you want to be respectful about your word. Like, I want my word to mean something, like, you
sure.
know what I'm saying? I don't want my word, me saying my word is bound on my dignity, on my pride, on my honor, for anyone to even think they could tamper with it over money or side talk, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
that's bad. Like, that's just bad, because that means you wasn't what y'all said y'all was in the beginning. That means somebody was lying, and you was lying.
Yeah,
part of it. So I think, you know.
Now was Missy running this Benjamin's?
I didn't even see Missy there.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't even, you know.
Because I remember hearing the Sheik say at the Cypher thing. Because I was on the Cypher thing before.
Yeah,
so.
He made it up. So
okay.
Yeah, he improvised and they ran with it.
Hey, listen,
it was cool.
It is what it is. But you know what? Even moving forward, you fuck with Netflix, Hard Body.
Yeah,
I always see you on Twitter.
Yeah.
Okay, Real Styles P.
Yeah.
Always talking about some Netflix shit.
Yeah, I watch
So
Netflix.
For the internet's listening, what shows are you suggesting that these people listen to? Or watch?
For right now, the 13th.
Okay, 13th.
13th.
Important.
Important. Requiem for a Dream.
Mm-hmm.
I've been watching a lot. Actually, the past few days, I've been watching Bill Burr.
Really?
Yeah, I had to take a time off and get a few days of laughing. And, you know what I mean? Because you watch a... I think it's important to be educated on what's going on somewhat and don't be fucking sleep. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
You can't always be sleep. Like, I tell everybody watch 13th and Requiem for a Dream. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's some kind of health shit if you into it.
I need to watch 13th. A lot of people told me, you know, I need to get on that definitely. And
yeah.
I'm like a homebody type dude.
Yeah.
So I fuck with Netflix officially. You
Netflix
know?
Is cool.
You know, you also...
I gotta get a check with them one day.
Shit, most definitely.
Should.
No
and they're doing a lot of original content, so hey,
no
listen,
doubt.
Netflix, how about Styles P? You know, one thing I also love about Styles P...
You gotta watch Stranger Things, too.
Oh, Stranger... That's right. I need to get on that. I got so much... It's hard to
Narcos,
watch everything. Narcos, yeah.
Luke
I fuck
Cage,
with Narcos.
Jessica Jones.
Blacklist.
I ain't get to that yet, you know, but
yeah,
Netflix
either.
Got a lot of shit, man. They're cool. They're doing pretty dope. House
Do you
of
like
Cards.
Orange is the New Black?
No. I didn't watch it yet.
Okay.
I don't dislike it, but I didn't watch it yet. I like watch something. I'll catch up on something.
Do you like Power? Who doesn't like Power? That was
I like Power
question.
A
yeah,
lot.
He
I like doesn't. Power a lot. I think 50 did a great job, and the rest of the people
You should be.
On
they should give you a cameo on that.
Did
that
a
would
great
be
job.
High.
Yeah.
Know?
Or
I like,
Empire.
I like
so you
Ghost.
Good with 50? Like, y'all cool?
Mm-hmm.
That's you good.
Cool.
Yo, it's even funny.
We'll definitely put you on the
it's
show
even
then.
Funny to see
we'll
like
be hanging out in no show
no,
like that.
No, I don't think that, but I mean like
speaking,
cordial because you
cool,
know he's
yeah.
a cancer, and
yeah.
cancers can get a little sensitive, and they hold grudges, and you know.
Yeah, I'm cool.
That's definitely.
No, but you
good
know
thing.
It's dope to see. You know, especially I feel like you know you become obviously a man of your word, but it's even funny to see like the whole. Remember the Locks and the or the D-Block and the Rough Rider and the Rockefeller days.
Yeah.
And then you think about how y'all got a partnership now with Rock Nation.
I'm
saying that's what you got. That, isn't that what you got? A partnership with Rock Nation?
I'm not telling you what we got. We just working.
No, but I like to see that,
we
man.
Just working.
Progressing, man. Progressing.
I'm not telling anybody what we got. Just wait for
but
us.
But a Locks album is coming.
Wait for us, baby.
Okay, so they say no more.
Wait for us.
You know, one thing I really always enjoyed about you, a fellow sneaker lover,
mm-hmm.
Styles P. Always, you know what I loved about Styles P.? He's not a regular Jordan dude, just a regular. I mean, this dude likes SBs. You still fuck with Janowskis and shit?
Yeah.
Yo, Styles is a fellow sneaker dude. You know, one thing I like to see is the dude, Ronnie Fagg. I like his come up.
Yeah.
I like, you know, I'm proud of him
yeah,
to
hard.
See how much he went. And I know he's tapped you to do a couple of things, the lookbook,
yeah.
et cetera.
Yeah.
What do you think of dude?
I love it, man.
Yeah.
I love it, man. Hip hop, man.
Yeah, it is.
It's hip hop. Hip hop is more than just music,
sure.
man. Like
it's,
you know, hip hop is working in a store,
sure,
in a fashion store, then and busting out your own fucking line because sure. it was involved.
That's hip hop.
Hip hop is you being a kid interested in what rappers talk about, becoming a journalist. You know what I'm saying? Hip hop is if you can't rap, you can dance. Hip hop is all fucking sort of things. Hip hop is the motherfucker behind the camera, the dude plugging up the radio, the dude turning on the boards and the things. So I love the aspects that, you know, all the angles hip hop reaches, and I love to see someone get money and be able to feed and provide for sure. families and multiple people and employ people. Because a lot of the times we don't look, and I try to tell you that's one of the reasons I don't get mad, because people are being employed. Mm. They being employed, and that's another dude off the corner, another true. Dude who ain't going to hit that slave ship because now he's unemployed. He's employed. He's an employee to the game. So, you know what I mean? Even
speaking
if you don't
employees.
Respect the game, he's still here.
What happened between you and Jay Hood, and are you guys good?
Who the fuck?
Yeah, God bless Jay Hood. That's still
that was
baby.
His like protege, and like he was like gonna be doing good things, and then for some reason God he turned.
You meant Jay Quan Tipsy? I said where he
no,
at?
No, I don't know where he
nah,
is.
Jay Hood, I wish him the best always as baby bro.
Right.
Discrepancies happen in life. That's some things happen in the industry. You know, he was younger. He had a lot of people in his ear with a lot of certain things. So I don't hold any grudges against him, and I always wish him the best. And, you know, pray for the best for him and his fam.
Did that kind of give you a bad taste in your mouth as far as, like, bringing on new talent? Because you haven't really, like, co-signed anybody like that since then.
We did the new No Security. Like, I open the door. You just really, take the door. You take the door right. how you want to take it. Like, right. you know what I'm saying? Right. To me, this is a... I go hard with this MC and shit. Like, I don't take this shit lightly. Like, you know what I'm saying? So, it's like when you want to... When you on the court, you just on the fucking court and going hard. You're welcome to get on the court with me. Just keep rocking.
Play one-on-one. Yo, I tell you, I said it before and I'll say it again.
But watch out for Fortez and Chris Rivers, you know what I'm saying?
No, uh-oh. I didn't
my
know
man,
that you...
Snipe Life, yeah,
first
I fuck
of all,
with them
I
tough.
Love... I didn't even yeah. know, like, that correlation. Yeah. Like, I'm with it. Like, I'm yeah. so excited about that.
Yeah, I sat with Chris Rivers and his mom before.
I met him
man.
When you yeah. guys interviewed yeah. him. Yeah, yeah. On the other show.
He's a dope, dope dude. Yo,
super.
Your Twitter is a life lesson. I told you
oh,
before you could
you,
write
bro.
A fucking book. Listen to me, I'm gonna
people
go
tell
over.
Me that. People no, say no. that here and
listen,
there, you know.
I got a couple of your tweets. Okay, I'm gonna go over them. Feel free to comment
so
on
then
them.
So we're not doing. I don't trust people. Okay. Well, this is the. I,
okay,
this
no,
is
we're
it.
Gonna go over it. Ready? I'm gonna go all over right, some. Cool. Listen, internet's on Twitter. The real Styles P. Listen to this motherfucker, and then P. You know, you feel free to comment. When I learned to drop my ego and pride. Life became more peaceful and profitable for me. Got a long way to go, though.
Yeah. I mean, I have a lot to learn. Like, you know what I'm saying? I got a lot to learn. I got a lot more I want to do. So that means I have a lot to learn. And, you don't become a master of peace overnight.
Sure.
Like, you know what I'm saying? I want to get to a point in my life where I master being peaceful. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I know I have a long way to go. But I know dropping my ego and my pride helped me a lot in the... You know,
in the industry?
No, I would say in my later years of the industry, and but with the more so of opening my mind and be able to expand my horizons and get into something like Juices for Life. Like if I wouldn't be in peace, I wouldn't have been able to have this brand now. There wouldn't be no Juices for Life because I'd still be running around with like a fucking knucklehead with
sure.
not sure what I want to do. So that's pretty much that.
Looking forward. Pushing forward, paying it forward.
Yeah, that's what I do. I'm looking where I want to go. I'm grinding hard to get there. And I've been blessed with a lot. So I think paying forward is... a lot of people talk about charity a lot. Like you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
And I think in the industry, we often hear about charity, what was given, what was done. I think in one way or the other, you have to pay it forward every day. Whether it's, you know, it might be a dollar to somebody, it might be $5 to somebody, might be a sweat off your back, might be a coat, might be a hug, might be a shoulder. It might just be, you know,
a
looking
compliment.
Out sometimes. Yeah, it might be a compliment. It might be, you know, taking one on a... Somebody might owe you a little bread and, you know, they don't really got it. You know, it might be like, yo, pay it forward. Hold somebody else down now because that kind of leaves you room in life to be in a good place and to push it forward. Like, so I know if I paid it forward... And if my son happened to be in a bad situation, hopefully somebody pay it forward to him. Mm-hmm. That might, you know, I might collect on something like that, so.
When the food is good, but the vibe and customer service ain't welcoming, it really sucks.
That's the worst, dog.
Yo, customer service in 2016 is horrible.
That is the worst. Like, I'm bad with bad customer service and with a good product. Because I feel like if I'm taking my time out to spend my money, because I'm frugal.
Yeah.
I'm frugal, dude. Yeah. I'm a rapper, but I ain't with all that just spending frivolously and all that shit. I'm very frugal with mine. So if I go to a place and like, and it's bad energy, especially if it's like food and somebody got like a nasty vibe and there's no, and it's bad customer service, that just fucking sucks, dog. That like really sucks. It blows the meal. You feel like you're wasting your money. And then it's like the food's good, but you don't want to come back. And it's just a whole bunch of bullshit to go through. In your head, think about, damn, the food's good. The customer service come back. Do I come back? Do I say something? If I say something, like, so it's just a fucked up position to be in. And I really, that really sucks to me. I hate that shit.
Mr. Internet, get your customer service up. You know, before you were talking about the birth of a nation at 13.
Yeah.
You tweeted before, black parents and white parents should make sure the youth see birth of a nation at 13 so they can understand the bullshit this country is on.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure, because I think there's so many things that happen in this country with black and white, and we fucking refuse to speak about it as black and white people. Like, I ain't saying we got to agree or whatever, but it got to be some kind of common understanding of, okay, that happened. Okay, this happened. Okay, this happened. Because, like, even, like, right now today as a black man, I'm fucking livid at all the Egypt movies. Like, them shits make me livid because I take it personal because I'm like, damn, we came up like that. We had to get the fucking knowledge from Rakim, Chuck, and KRS that actually, and you know, the ox on the corner, that fucking actually Egyptians was black because by TV, I thought they was white when I was a little kid. So now here we go all over fucking again in 2016. I know every black kid that's watching Gods of Egypt and all these fucking other Egyptian movies, and school ain't going to tell them too much about Egypt, ain't even going to tie themselves with being to or from Egypt or Africa, period, which is fucking crazy. Like, so it's crazy. So it's just like as black and white, we need to be able to say, okay, this is where you from, this is what happened. This what happened. This is this part of history. That really happened. Slavery really happened. It ain't just get over it.
Sure,
like, you know
sure,
what I'm saying?
Exactly.
It's like, it's certain shit. And it's like, you know, it's certain shit that people just like, you know, if it was, if the jail system wasn't what the way it was now and cops wasn't killing black kids every fucking other day now, then, you know, maybe we would be fucking exaggerating. You could say we're exaggerating. But look at the numbers, dog. Look at the numbers. Like, look at the, like, go home and look at the numbers. And, you know, sometimes if you're in a good position, and it's hard to speak on something if you're in a good position and you benefiting, why the fuck say anything? Like, you know what I'm saying? But then you got to think, is that good for a whole as people? Is that good for a whole people? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I watched that. I forgot that lady's name. I wish I had the clip. It was the lady on the internet. It was just breezing through the white lady. Yeah, the white lady. When she said,
I love her.
That shit fucked me up, though.
She's real.
She was real. That was some real shit. She told,
stand up.
Stand up if you want to live like, you know, the black people's society. Nobody fucking stood up. Yeah. That's real shit. Like, so we have to get to the point of speaking on certain issues and certain topics and understand. Because black is black. White is white. But there's also black and white. There's like, what the fuck are you gonna do? Like, fuck all the mixed people. Hey, you mixed mulatto motherfucker. Fuck you. You don't count. You. What do you do with them? Like, that's a human being.
Right.
What about the person that's half black and fucking half white? Like, seriously. Like, what the fuck do you? Like, how can you really? You half hate that person? Like, are you fucking dick? We in like 2016. Like I hate racist people. Yeah. But I'm beyond a point where I could just hate somebody for being white. Like, it used to be a point I used to be like, I feel bad for racist people. Because it's like, you're a caveman. Like, you either a caveman or a real devil or some crazy shit if you really just hate a person over their fucking color.
Right.
Or the way they look. You're like evil. Like, you're straight devil or you're straight fucking wherever the fuck you from. Something's wrong with you. Black, white, or indifferent. Like, something's wrong with you if you just could just naturally feel like that. Like, you know what I'm saying? And I think it's just a lot of things in this country we need to get out. Like, I don't understand how the fucking Colin Kaepernick is the only motherfucker who's taking a stand. Like, to me, that's fucking loony. Like, I'm pretty sure there's some other players, but I mean, like...
Right, that's making a
like,
real,
you know, I mean, like, what
noise.
The fuck? Like, so it's
they're
like...
So
I don't know.
And the world, some of the world still don't
And it's
get
like
it.
The fucking... He ain't lying. That shit was a fucked up anthem made by a racist dude.
Well, here's the
fuck
thing.
Fuck that dude. Fuck the anthem. That shit got nothing to do with the soldiers. Fuck the pledge while we at it. Because even when I was young, I used to be like, they made this shit when we were slaves, though.
Right. Yeah, because you know what?
So when they said liberty and justice for all, when they made that statement up,
they didn't even, Toy wasn't talking about
we that. Wasn't fucking included. No. Like, why the fuck we got to stand by it?
When they
like,
said the land of the free.
Yeah.
They weren't talking
about
the
slave. Yeah,
what
the fuck?
The
like, that's like... Remix that shit, man.
Even like when we're celebrating Christopher Columbus discovering some shit that already happened.
Like, come on, like,
here,
stop that shit. Like, and it's beyond the point, and it's like, you know, white America don't want to acknowledge the flag, the anthem. And that shit is full of shit. Like, whether you know, no disrespect to people who laid their lives down, to the soldiers who's laid their lives down for this country. That's not the point we're talking about. We're talking about the point of the fucking shit being made up when black with no acknowledgement for black people
right.
as a common equal citizen, let alone human being.
Right. Mm. And you're telling us this
let
is
alone so human being, but I got to keep fucking coming here and singing this fucking
right.
Oh Say Can You See and I got to say with liberty and justice for all and the land of the free and home of the brave when I fucking know they was taking the skin off motherfuckers' backs
right.
and stomping babies out and raping great aunts and great like come on like I ain't like come on like and then I watched that shit when I watched that shit from what's my man's name Michael Moore what's his latest one
I don't know his latest one
what
I
the
just...
fuck is the name of that but he was going to different countries like they Germany was acknowledging what they did to the Jews like as you walk the fucking streets it's like this amount of Jews got killed right here. And it's like, that's
where
real shit.
Next?
You can't move on. Yeah. Where to invade next? You can't move on until you acknowledge the problem. Like, that's like a relationship at home. Like, that's like you with your spouse or your other.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Think about it. Like, your wife pisses you off. Your lady pisses you off. Vice versa. You don't settle it. You don't say shit about it. You just let it go. Or you say a little bit about it, but you let it go. And then you keep moving on, and you keep moving on, you keep... That relationship ain't right. Y'all just fucking fronting because you didn't get to the nitty-gritty
mm-hmm.
of what the problem is. And that's what's happening with white America and black America.
Right.
It's like a relationship that ain't right because you ain't really talking about getting... It ain't like you went to therapy or had the real talk
right.
about really here's what the fuck is going on, here's what's happened, and got the feelings out because it's like a hidden thing. Like
mm-hmm.
I always felt like I feel... I it was funny. I was walking the other day, and this was last fucking month. I was fucking walking from my crib. I was walking to Whole Foods, and I was walking on the strip, and it was an older white lady in front of me, and she kept turning back, looking at me, and she kind of clutched her bag. Now I wanted to get past her, but I was scared to move at
right.
a certain amount of speed because I didn't want to fucking startle her. And the thing, now it's broad day. We on a strip in White Plains, New York. And I'm like, why the fuck do I got to think like this?
Right.
So you know what? I walked past her. I sped past her, but I walked so fast that she could feel comfortable that I was way ahead of her. Then I'm like, this is some bullshit. Like, and I'm saying in my mind, this is some fucking bullshit. This country ain't moving nowhere. And that's all I can say in my mind. Then five younger white ladies is walking towards me, and they got their work uniforms on, their badges, they dress real, like, corporate and shit. Oh, shit, Styles P! And they was white, and it fucked me up, and I was like, oh, shit, like, can I get a picture? Oh, I love you! So I stopped them taking a picture of them. Now the old white ladies walking by me and them going crazy over me and taking a picture, and she's looking. She's ahead of me again. I end up beating her to Whole Foods. Now I got to hold the door open for her because I made it to the door before she
right.
did. I really don't want to hold the door open for her, but that'd be fucking rude as fuck. And my mother raised me better than that.
Right.
So I hold the door open for her. It killed her. Like, I seen the agony in her face to say thank you. She didn't want to say thank you, but it would have been like, She would have been new. She would have been a piece of shit for not saying thank you. I wanted to say, though, for the first, in the first place, lady, and I really want to ask white people, how the fuck do you feel so scared of us?
Right.
Like,
y'all did more to us than we did
yeah,
you.
Yeah, like, you can't be that scared. Like, I'm fucking terrified of police, period. I got to teach my son to stay away from police. Every black man got to teach his son to be careful as you can. Keep quiet. Put your hands up if you could. Stay away. I said, I got to think. My mom's from Africa. So I got to hear stories. My mom's from South Africa.
Wow.
So I know, you know, I got to hear hearing stories of my mom's past. So to me, I always look like from slavery to this fucking jail system to the court system to the fucking supermarket, difference in the foods from the supermarkets in a poor neighborhood. How the fuck are you scared of me? Like, I should be terrified because you fucking doing everything you could do to take us out. Not all white people in general, I'm not saying, but
it's like the system.
It's like the system that's in place, and then those who ain't saying nothing, you part of it.
Right.
If you living, standing by, not saying shit and just living with it, you fucking part of it. Like, you part of it.
You're consistent.
And just like us on our behalf as people and as rappers and people from the street, we got to take our responsibility too and say, we got to calm the fuck down. We know the laws is unfair. We got to stop breaking the laws.
Right. Show them that we're not animals.
We know poverty's causing motherfuckers to go crazy, get mad, pop each other up. We got to find a way to get ourselves healthy so we can think a little better, to find better options to get out of poverty, to maybe start spending the money with each other. So maybe if we can start creating jobs all on our own and keep that, and not just black. I'm talking about, because I feel poor white people or white people that's really in hip-hop, you a nigga.
They can only call nigga, one of their uncles, though.
You a nigga, like you. But if you poor in the hood, you a that's nigga, true. Like you kind of booked in there, like
you actually tweeted. Got to learn to start spending my money with people that are easily gonna think about spending it back with me.
Yeah, because I'm tired of this shit. Like you spend all this fucking money, and it's fucking especially because fucking rap is like the fucking devil's son and dance with it. This shit is the fucking beast. We spend all our money. And it's not circulating in the community. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's not enough fucking circulation of the dollar. Like, why the fuck am I going to spend my money with somebody who doesn't even fucking know I exist? And if they did, they probably still not going to spend the money with me.
Sure.
That's fucking stupid on my behalf. Like, and I'm really starting to feel stupid over it. That's why, like, I try to buy a lot of G-Star now.
Okay.
Pharrell's the owner over here. Like, I used to go... And no knock to Ralph Lauren because he hired black models, but I'm not getting no fucking money back from Ralph. I've spent no fucking mad years of my life collecting Ralph Lauren. I got fucking Ralph Lauren furniture and bedspreads and drawers, all kind of shit. Nah, but what the fuck? Like, what the fuck was
it?
Because it's Ralph Lauren, and man, I should have saved that shit and invested it in somebody who would have, even because there ain't no bad people, I'm going to get the shit back, but should have bought a cheaper bed. Or invested in it somewhere where I'm going to get my money back.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, when the fuck did Ralph Lauren give a rapper a check?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, literally, like, when the fuck are we going to get it?
Yeah.
When are we going to get a check, Ralph?
Right.
Like, seriously, like, Ralph. Like, even if you don't want to deal with a dirty ghetto rapper, there's fucking plenty of cleaned up rappers for you to deal with for how much money you get. Like,
I mean,
but that even
like when's
Trick
Nike
Daddy
gonna give a rapper a check?
Trick Daddy would always say, hell nah, hold his polo, and he asked for a check and they said no, and he said he stopped saying that, and then he started talking about Iceberg.
Yeah, but even look at somebody like Grand Pooba, who put Hilfiger on his back.
He didn't want us wearing it.
On his back. And he said, I mean, I don't know, I can't count him, but I remember I met him and we spoke. And I think they just sent him some stuff. Maybe that was the farthest they went, you know? And, you know, it should be more than that, especially people who are being spokesmen, you know?
Yeah.
I'm going to go through a couple. I'll just go through. If you want to comment, you comment. The real Styles P, his Twitter is like a fucking Bible.
Wait, can I ask you a question? Because your real name starts with a D. So how come you picked P? What does that stand for? Because your last name is Styles.
Mm-hmm.
First name starts with a D.
Mm-hmm.
Where does the P come from?
Pacino and De Niro.
Forget about it.
Okay.
Forget about it. Listen, like I said,
the mixture.
The real Styles P. His Twitter's like a Bible. Don't shit where you eat, and don't eat where you can trust people. Where you can't trust people.
Yeah.
If you smoke, drink, party, work, hustle, hard and barely sleep, have sex often. Your body deserves some healthy stuff put into it. Remember that.
He's plugging the juice spot, right?
I mean, listen, being
juice is for life.
Yeah.
Some people don't have
it. That was more important. Like, it's not about, like, this is what we say real quick at the juice bar. And I want everyone to know this. I want everyone to understand me clearly who's listening. We have 4 juice bars. That's not enough to nearly reach all the people we need to reach.
Yeah, you need to go
we tell
West Coast.
Everybody, get a juicer, get a blender. If you look on our shit, we put all our recipes on the menu. You got to do it at home because that's what's the most important. Like, yeah, I want to get money, you know what I mean? But I'm going to get money because I work naturally.
Right.
That's a natural cause and effect, far as I see. Sometimes it might not be always what it's supposed to be, but hey, shit happens like that. Sometimes it's over. Shit happens like that too. So you take it as what this is, so it's bigger than juicing. We want you to be healthy. We want you to juice up. We want you to get a juicer. We want you to get a blender. We want you to watch what you're eating. We want you to exercise. We want you to be healthy. We want you to kind of pray, meditate.
And
you
live
do
longer.
Whatever it is, just to be a better person. Because whether you're in hip-hop, you're in the streets, don't be fucking scared to be the best you could be. Mm-hmm. Don't let fucking the media and what's cool and what's popping take that from you. And this is why we fucked up now, because we always chasing the fucking stupid shit. Like, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, ain't no need in getting the fucking Bentley if you can't drive it. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's no need. It's,
get a Cadillac STS.
Right.
Nah, I mean, if you ain't healthy to drive it, what the fuck
right.
is
no,
the
no,
use
no, you make, right.
like, you know
it
what
makes
mean?
All the so, sense in the world. Let me run through these last Twitterverse Bibles from Styles P. Some people don't have it in them to listen. Wait, hold on. Some people don't have it in them to listen to you and hear your vision. Don't let that stop you, though. Sometimes you could be dealing with a future big timer who happens to be in a small time position at the moment. Got to be able to see the potential. I love that one.
Yeah.
I love that one.
Yeah.
And then what you said is instant gratification will always be pleased with mediocre shit.
Yeah.
And I honestly do my best to stay positive because it don't take much for me to be a complete ignorant pain, bringing asshole with no regard.
True.
I like that.
True.
I respect the person because of who they are, not what they own, because there was times that I didn't have shit. And I would never forget that.
Never.
I mean, I think that's always important.
Never,
that,
never.
You know?
I can never forget that. Being fucked up is humbling. I think anybody, if you fucked up, you want to stay humble.
I feel like
remember
we're like,
your
you are like a big
day.
Brother in my head. Like, I already fucked with you's hard
love
body,
love,
but
sis.
Now it's like even better. Like,
because
I set a prayer alarm, so I've been doing my own form of meditation. I definitely juice. And
you need that shit.
I'll do like wheatgrass shots. And
you need that shit.
You guys should do that with a lemon wedge because it's a little sour than wheatgrass.
And God
shots.
Is your that's publicist. Cool.
And God is my publicist.
That's dope.
Listen.
I like that.
Here's
I'm
another
gonna
one.
I'm going to send you some apparel.
Like
it's coming.
You can't count money. No, you can count money. But you can't count love, because there ain't no way to write the amount down. That was deep.
It's a fact.
We make gotta sure, offer. Make sure y'all following this man. What's your
real the real Styles P? Yeah,
real
make
Styles
sure on Instagram
and
Twitter.
Nah, I'm the real Styles P on Twitter. I'm real Holiday Styles on the gram.
Where did the holiday come from?
Holiday Styles.
Nah, I was born in. No, I was actually I was born on a Thanksgiving day, and D from Rough Riders and a few of my homies used to always call me Doc Holiday.
Oh,
on my
Doc
you know,
Holiday.
That was my you know my wild
your
days.
Moniker.
All right, you ready? We're gonna finish this up right here. Make sure the people you care about you, or you're gonna have to remix your life.
Yeah,
understand that, internet. Tell people you a boss. They want your position. Wait, hold on. Tell people you're a boss, they want your position.
Ow.
Tell people you work hard, they want nothing to do with your position.
Word. Because people don't want to do the hard work.
Everybody
want
to be a boss.
Yeah.
Everybody want to be a boss.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, if you tell somebody, come with me, we're going to go work hard today. It's like,
yeah, man, I'll see you later.
Come with me, I'm a boss up. They're going to come with you. Mm-hmm. But the boss is supposed to work hard. That's how you get to
the
boss
position.
The boss
should do more work than anybody else. Like,
yeah.
You got to make sure that you're not going to ask somebody to do a job that you wouldn't do yourself.
Yeah, I love this one. He gives credit. I'm a New Yorker to the core, but ain't nothing in the world like California weed.
Nothing in the fucking
fuck
world.
Fuck what you heard.
Word up. I love New York, but my lungs are truly California. I'm a California boy at heart when it comes to smoking, man. I tell you, I am no bullshit.
Ooh-wee, shout
you
out
like
to...
You like those oil pens?
I'm more of the flower power. I was doing that before. But I had to leave all that alone. I feel strange about it for some reason sometimes. So
I feel like it's like fake.
I try to stay away from it.
Yeah.
Many times in my lifetime, I didn't want beef, but my pride wouldn't allow me to say it, and I end up paying for it. I mean, listen, wisdom, man, wisdom.
Yeah, that's real.
I did a lot of times. I think when you come from the ghetto and you got a reputation, it's so hard to say, I don't want a problem. Like, you know what I'm saying? Even if you don't want a problem, it's like, hell yeah, I want a problem. Fuck y'all niggas. Like, whatever. You're going to pay for that.
Sure.
You're going to pay for that because you got to follow your first instinct. You got to follow your intuition. And sometimes you got to know how to swallow your pride because some people end up paying with their lives. I mean, like, you know, getting laid down. Some people end up paying with their lives, getting a long, a stretch in jail. And some people end up paying with their lives and just losing a shitload of money and future opportunities. Sure. So.
Could be cash, death, you know.
You know.
You even wrote nothing wrong with saying you don't want beef either. If you don't want beef, don't let your pride make you contest the wrong challenger. You know?
I see that a lot. I see a lot of people scared to tell another person, like, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with telling somebody you don't want a problem. Like, you know what I mean? I think that's an honorable thing to do if you actually don't want a problem. And then some people not wanting a problem don't mean you won't have a problem. Like, you know what I mean? Me selling you I don't want a problem does not equate out to I won't handle the problem.
Right.
Mm. I'm just man enough to tell you I don't want the problem. That's where people, you know, get the lines drawn or misconfused because you might as well save yourself the time because a lot of us worry about looking like a sucker
right.
in front of somebody else. But you're going to end up getting in trouble and looking like a sucker to your old lady, your kid, because you ain't around.
Your
family. And then yourself when you're sitting behind bars for a duck. Like, and I always say that, too. If I'm ever getting a thing, I don't want to be – it's going to be a reputable dude who I knew I had to worry about or some shit that just happened spur of the moment and I had no choice. Other than that, you won't even catch me engaging with no duck.
Sure, you got that right.
Too much bullshit.
Here's a couple of last ones. Ego and pride can get you killed or locked up forever. Be easy out there. And then some shit you do for the buck, some shit you do for the cause. Don't get them too confused.
Yeah.
And let's see what we got. We got a couple more. I did more than enough G shit, actually enough for 10 men in 2 lifetimes. Let me find a little peace and quiet and spread my love.
Word.
And,
that's what I'm trying to do, man. I just want to spread love, bro. I just want to be at peace. I just want to be chilling.
I just
want to fucking fall back and chill and smoke like a hippie and relax and grow plants and veggies and get high and
eat butternut squash.
And do weird shit with my homies, like shit like that. Like,
listen, this is one of the best ones you wrote. When your best ain't good enough, get better.
Yeah.
I love that.
I'm a firm believer in
your bond and loyalty with your brothers should never be broken over a dollar bill.
Never.
And then you wrote, dear young fellow with no record, keep it that way. The pain and headaches that comes with having a felony fucking sucks.
I fucking preach. I got it. Somebody got to do the preaching.
Young fella, stay away from the felonies. Pork, third-party drugs, and going raw dog.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, there's so much shit. I can't even get into any more, but one thing I do want to say is that, like, a lot of, like, I know I appreciate not only your contributions to hip-hop, but just your contributions to life, because I'll be honest with you, a lot of your tweets, what we don't realize is that they hit people at the right time, you know, and...
Yeah, love is love.
You know, I remember you saying one time, you said, those suffering from losing a loved one, stay strong and know a spirit or soul can never die.
That never dies.
And look forward to reuniting with that spirit later. You know, one thing I do want to really appreciate you.
Always
When my daughter turns 16, sweet 16, I remember I hit you. And, I remember I told you, I said, my daughter loves, the Locks. She loves Jada. She loves Styles. And the next day you hit me back with that video for her sweet 16.
Love is love.
And, it's an amazing thing to be able to put your blessings upon, your kids' blessings.
For sure.
And, I want to end this on a note just to, really go over, I know that you had a tragedy in your family.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why I'm bringing it up on some G shit is because a lot of us go through situations, ourselves.
Yeah.
Depression, just situations where we feel like...
Stay strong, man.
Life gets tough.
Stay strong. Gotta stay
and
strong.
And even as a father to my daughter, sometimes, you know, sometimes it's hard to reach a teenager.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes they feel like, you know, I'll give you an example. I speak to my daughter, and sometimes she'll be like, I don't like my friends. I don't like anybody. Yeah. And she don't want to talk. Sometimes that I don't live with her, because she lives with her mother, my ex-wife, I worry about her. And, you know, I don't know, when that happened with you and your family, man, you know, I never told you this, but, you know, really, you know, I prayed for y'all.
Thank you.
And.
Thank you.
You know. It.
I still need the prayers. I need them every day.
No, I know, because.
I'm lacking on prayers.
It's scary.
I need
to
pray more myself. I got you.
I'm a three. I pray three times a day.
That's good.
You in it.
That's good. I had a bad week. I think my foot hurt. I had a long week.
And I've been burning sage.
From lacking on prayers.
Yeah.
I really feel like, honestly, like when you, because it's the energy
it's
you put
true.
Out. I really feel like the energy you put in and you put out to the universe, it'll give you back. So you just got to watch what you do, you know?
Yep.
Yeah. No, but I appreciate you, you know.
Love is love.
Just doing that for my kid, knowing of what you went through and stuff like that. So
I mean, it's painful. You know, I miss my baby girl every day. But I know she's with me in spirit, you know what I mean? Yeah. You know, it's a lot of people suffer from a lot of things, especially pain. So you got to wake up, breathe deep, give it up to God, and keep moving.
Yeah. And I really just think, talk about it. You know, even you see like a Kid Cudi. You know, you see like...
God bless him.
He admits he's going through some shit, you know?
He's going to rehab, right?
Yeah. And he's going through some...
That's good. I feel bad for him.
But
he's a good dude.
But, you know, it's important that, you know, you spoke before, and on the ending note, we spoke before how we don't go to the doctor.
Yeah.
A lot of us, a style that we grew up with.
Yeah.
We don't go to the doctor. We don't talk about when we have problems. So, you know, I'm just trying to get better. Every
day, push it forward.
No, most definitely, just because, also for our kids.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, like you spoke about, so, you know.
Got to.
Love is love, you know, but.
All day.
And ending this episode, I want to say, yo, this shit, you got me all, man.
Shit,
it's a touchy subject, man.
Yeah.
It's a touchy subject, but I just want to let you know, yo, honestly, my prayers are with you.
Thank you, brother.
And, mine too, and it kind of makes me feel bad, because sometimes I get annoyed by my daughter. Like, I'm just like a new mom, single mom, and like I really want her to understand how much I really do love her, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you want to cherish those moments, and yeah. Make sure.
It's hard because sometimes, you know, like people, like I could have never told you anything was wrong with my daughter. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I don't, you know, I just felt she had a bad moment in life. So with that, whether like, you know, people do the mental awareness thing and things of that nature. But the truth is, you won't always be able to see it.
Right.
So your best bet is to be good with everybody all the time. You know, and get an understanding of life. Like, I'm pretty sure my daughter's probably in the room with me right now, or close, or when I get in the crib. Mm-hmm. You know, my beliefs are a little different from everybody else's.
I'm the same way. I'm really big on energy.
You know what I'm saying?
Travels.
So I already know certain things, you know. But you got to stay strong, because everybody's always at some point or another down. Because everybody, when you get on this net and this Instagram and this Twitter and it's popping and it's lit and latest fashion and this is dope, you don't really get to get in tune with that pain. Like, you know what I'm saying? You try to block it out, which is cool, and you're supposed to, but you got to get in touch with it, get a good cry to get a good laugh sometimes.
Right. No, that's true.
You know? Sometimes you got to cry and got to laugh.
And you got to stay focused. But what's next? What could the internet expect from
More
Styles
Juice
P?
Bars, yep. LOX album, couple books, and...
Personal book? Regular book?
Actually, me and my wife were working on, like, How We Eat. Like, a How We Eat book.
Like
and
a
then
recipe
we,
book?
Yeah, like a kind of a little more than that. Really a lifestyle a book, because a lot of people think, like, when you get healthy or you do something healthy, like you just got the answer to fucking everything. We all need support. It's about a support group and just understanding about the lifestyle, because you can eat healthy, you can work out. There's going to be a time you might stop eating healthy, you might stop working out, you know, you might do whatever. So it's just about living a lifestyle and the things you do to keep the lifestyle going. We got a few things. I don't want to give too much up.
I have an idea. I don't want to throw it at right now either, but I'm telling you, we cousins.
No doubt.
We just got to go that line. I'm somewhere in the lineage.
For sure we are.
And but, you didn't have no reception, so we're going to do that on the outside.
Listen, yeah, internet's first of all, Styles, like I said, you know, great episode. I'm glad we finally got to get this done.
No doubt.
You know, your wisdom is definitely appreciated across these internets. Your contributions are appreciated. I appreciate you.
Yo, is it too much to ask to get at least an 8?
Nah.
I just feel like...
I'm going to send y'all some.
All
right. I ain't coming. Y'all got me emotional. I'm tearing and shit.
Oh,
I can't kick
God
an
bless
8
you.
When I'm tearing.
Nah,
I didn't see you tearing.
Nah.
You're amazing.
It dropped like...
You're amazing.
Yeah,
like
I seen
a little
it.
Native
this
American
the one
tear.
Thug, yeah, the one
the
thug
little
tear.
Native American
Yeah, I miss my baby girl. I miss my baby girl. And I feel him because I feel the situation, you know, on the thing. But you got to stay strong. You got to talk to the kids every day.
Yeah.
And everybody. Shit, we all in fucking pain.
No, that shit
everybody
is true.
Laughing, but everybody in a little pain here and there.
We always say that.
Somewhere down the line.
Nah, and
smiles don't mean happy.
And the kids, I always say presence over presence. And, you know, I mean, being there. And I've seen you throughout the years be there for your kids and still to this day.
No doubt.
You know, it's everything in life. You know, if we don't pass on, we don't live on. So, internets, listen, we'll see you next episode.
Later, internet.
Styles P.
LOX, D-Block, love you. Juices for life. Get your juicer, get your blender, eat right, watch what you eat, pray, meditate, do all that shit, and light one.
Cheer.
Ow.